Sorry dat ik... excuseer. Ik ga eventjes het gesprek. Goedenavond, iedereen. Heel fijn om te zien dat jullie ook weer zo talrijk aanwezig zijn vanavond. Ook heel fijn voor zij die daarnet ons al hebben vergezeld tijdens het diner. Ik hoop dat jullie er evenveel van genoten hebben als ik dat gedaan heb. We zijn aangekomen bij het volgende element van onze avond en dat is het panelgesprek rond globaal en lokaal burgerschap. De vraag die we ons vandaag gaan stellen is, hoe kunnen we van Gent niet alleen een solidaire stad, maar ook een sanctuary city spelen? Hoe maken we een humaner, een correcter regularisatiebeleid? En welke rol kunnen steden zoals Gent daarin spelen?
Thank you, Aline. And I also wanted to say thank you for the last 2 years working together on this. I'm talking to you now in English because also this panel will be in English. because we have speakers from all over the world tuning in. And I just want to present also to the global audience that is listening to you right now, to us right now, that we are a format that tries to connect global conversations on strategies of resistance, as we call them, with local initiatives. And I think the last 2 days have shown that this kind of method works, that we can bring in speakers from all over the world, also via streaming methods or Zoom. We all know this now after 2 years of the pandemic. But connecting it to our great partners, local initiatives like Gens Sonder Grenzen. Thank you also, Marlies and Frederik, for the amazing work. And In My Name campaign, that's Marius and Shanturu, who are amazing partners in that. And also La Coordination de Sans-Papiers, La Union de Sans-Papiers, Tariq. And I just also want to say that we are happy to have partners for all over the world. We started this with the Wiener Festwochen. We had partners at the Akademie der Künste in Berlin, Münchner Kammerspiele, Schauspiel Köln. We had partners in the Siegel Center in New York City. And so we're very happy to be in Ghent with our School of Resistance today. And now I give the word to John, who will also introduce our guests today. Thank you.
Good evening. I think we have an interesting panel. The first person I would like to present, I expect her on the screen very soon, Professor Jacqueline Bhabha is a British academic and lawyer. Her research and legal practice focus on citizenship, immigration law, human trafficking, and human smuggling. In 2018, she published the book, Can We Solve the Migration Crisis? Then, at the other side of the table, we have Bilal Abbas. He is the founder of Masala Vzw, an organization whose main goal is to bring diversity to art and culture in the city of Ghent. After its foundation in 2017, the association grew into a well-known partner in the city of Ghent. Bilal is one of the ambassadors of Ghent Zonder Grenzen, the Ghent Citizens Movement for a humane and solidarity-based asylum and migration policy. Next to Bilal, we have Professor Ellen Desmet. She teaches migration law at the Faculty of Law at the University of Ghent and is a member of the Center for Human Rights here in the university. In 2021, she published the report Moving Cities, City Report Ghent, Comprehensive Policies and Extraordinary Collaboration, a study that investigates the Ghent migration and integration policy. Next to Ellen, we have Astrid De Bruycker, the elder woman, because I thought that the elder man is not suitable for a woman, but the elder women for equal opportunities, welfare, participation, neighborhood work, and public green for the city of Ghent. Hope I don't have forgotten something, Astrid. Competent for the city's migration and integration policy. And then close to me is Parwana Amiri. She's a poet and human rights activist. A few weeks after she arrived in the refugee camp of Moria in Greece, she started a weekly blog called Letter to the World from Moria, through which she gave an insight into the painful daily reality at the borders of Europe and empowered refugees to make their voices heard. She recently published her first collection of poetry, My Pen Won't Break, But Borders Will. I think we will have a taste of that at 8:45, when our discussion stops and Parwana will bring some poetry. But okay, so we have a lot of ground to cover. Can you hear us, Professor, in the States? Yes. Okay.
Yes, loud and clear.
Yeah. So we live in a special time, special week. We have 1 million people who have left Ukraine. I must say, in my adult life, I have had several waves of conflict-related refugee waves, in fact, Bosnia, Kosovo, Iraq, Syria, Afghanistan, and now we have Ukraine. And so there are many other reasons why people migrate, ecological, economic. Hence my question, could you say that we have always had migration and that in fact migration is part of la condition humaine, the human condition? Professor Bhabha, what do you think?
First of all, thank you so much for organizing this very timely panel and for the really heartwarming collection of people that you brought together. I'm so happy to join you, and I wish I was in Ghent rather than in a very, very cold Massachusetts. But having said that, yes, your question is absolutely right, that we've always had migration. It is part of la condition humaine. It's been how human beings have sought opportunity, how they've sought safety, of course, how they have also sought to dominate and colonize and exploit and exterminate. But for better or for worse, migration is very much part of who we are as human animals. And also, I think more specifically, distress migration, as I call it, this migration where people are forced to leave their homes, not of their choosing, for whatever reasons, is also now part of our condition. And so we should stop thinking of it as just a crisis, even though there are obviously moments of particular extreme need and extreme movement like we're seeing at the moment. So yes, it's inherent in who we are, it's inherent in the way in which we organize our lives. And that means that we should be adequately prepared and open to the enormous need that arise when people are forced to flee for safety and to protect their lives.
You already opened the door to my next question, and that is whether it is the case that migration is always coupled with kind of resistance or tension in the recipient societies, or whether that depends on certain conditions. Because I wasn't there at the time in the 60s, but I can imagine that, and I still felt it a little bit in the 70s, that the migration from the Mediterranean countries like Turkey or Morocco in the 70s was not problematized, if you compare it to now. But so my question is more open. Do you see very often resistance in recipient countries or societies against migration? I recall, for instance, in the 17th century, it springs to my mind that the golden century of Amsterdam, more than half of the population were migrants coming from Germany all the time, because it was a deadly city. Many people died all the time, and new migrants came from Germany. So, but okay, you started to answer.
No, so this is an important point. I think that there are both elements. I think until really relatively recently in our history, until the beginning of the 20th century, there were very few migration controls. And actually, migration was seen as an asset. Human beings were seen as a plus for countries. Of course, in some cases, human beings were enslaved and forcibly moved to exploit their labor. But even when that wasn't the case, or when there wasn't indenture, the arrival of people was generally seen as something positive, because you were increasing your labor force, you were going to increase the wealth of your population. And so, just like you described with Amsterdam, so it was with many, many other places that were open and welcoming. But at the same time, and this has also always been the case, there have been exclusion, stigmatization based on religious differences or racial differences or nationality differences more recently. So you have both. You have this, and you still see that actually. You see the desire for openness. You see large portions of the world who move very freely and to benefit, and who benefit the countries that they move to. And then you see equally large portions who encounter enormous increasing obstacles. So I think it's a combination of openness and closure. And what we witness now, in a way, is a legacy, I think, of a colonial period where the world is divided into populations that can move easily, without obstacles, seamlessly across the world, actually, in a day or two. And if you need visas, you get visas. And if you need to get COVID tests, you get COVID tests. And then others typically colonized populations, brown and black populations, who can't move, even when they desperately need to, and who are forced to take very tortuous routes. So these are the resistances that you're talking about. So I think we witness both. And I think one of the most perverse aspects of our current moment is that the hostility to much forced migration renders people much more helpless than they would otherwise be, because they have to embark on extraordinarily dangerous journeys, long journeys, journeys which deplete their resources, deplete their strength, often place them at enormous risk, so that when they do finally arrive somewhere safe, they are much more dependent on support than they would otherwise have been.
Now we have said this, so I just want to put it here in the group. Is it a useful metaphor to say that we have, in a way, a moment of global apartheid, in the sense that apartheid in South Africa was based on, you had inequality of chances based on the color of your skin. And now, in a way, you could say that life chances very much depend on the place where you were born, and that these differences are defended with the power of states, barbed wires, guards, walls. And so it's, I don't know if it's a useful metaphor, but I just want to put it in the group. Professor Desmet, I see you nodding. You seem to find it a good metaphor, but yeah.
No, I see you nodding because I'm nodding because indeed it has been used in migration scholarship to describe the concept of deported there has been used to describe precisely, you know, the fact that, as Professor Bhabha was saying, that people, some people can travel without visas, without any costs, other people cannot travel or without documents, don't receive a residence right from the state where they want to build their life. Mm-hmm. So you have a kind of new categorization of people that have very different access to their human rights, to which they're all entitled.
I sometimes think I use that word maybe maybe it's irritating, this word, but it can maybe also help to put some things in perspective, in a sharp perspective. I don't know, Professor Bhabha, you're nodding or you're saying no? Let's
yes
leave this
no.
word.
I think it's useful because it's provocative and it makes us see the inequality starkly. There are particularities to apartheid that don't apply to the racism and exclusionary mechanisms that we see in migration. So it's like when people talk about concentration camps or Nazis, you know, these are very powerful and provocative terms which alert us to the danger of a particular situation, but they may have a limit. So in terms of the notion of apartheid, global apartheid as it applies to migration, I would say that it has its limits because a lot can be done, as we're now seeing with Ukraine. A lot can be done if states take the responsibilities that they are charged with and anticipate need rather than waiting for disaster to happen or waiting for destitution to happen before they intervene. So what I mean to say is that if, and you know, this is a school of resistance, which I love the name that you've used, if you generate through your state policy support for communities of solidarity, then those communities will continue to be strong. But if you undermine solidarity by failing to cater to the needs of host communities, then what you're doing is perpetuating exclusion and perpetuating a situation which you could say is one of gross inequality. And if you want to say apartheid, that may have some bearing. But there's nothing inevitable about it. In fact, it's preventable. And that's what I think we need to emphasize.
I sometimes use that word because maybe it can help us inspire to the first thing maybe you could do if people arrive here to in search of a better life is to treat them respectfully and maybe using such a provocative word can help. I don't know. And now I look to Parwana and when you arrived in Europe, how do you experience the reception that you arrived in Moria, I think? Did you think this was a kind reception here? I don't know. It's open.
Can I take the microphone?
I can help you.
No, I can take it. Thank you. I have. Is it on?
It's on, I think. Okay. Yes. Put it close to your mouth.
Okay. Thank you for referring to this question. Honestly, when I was in Moria, I would never imagine that we would have the first, you know, welcoming like that. When we were in Moria, the first welcoming on the, you know, in front of the gate was by the previous residents. They were calling "Welcome to Hell." So it was the first, you know, image that I will ever keep in my mind is that. And after that, they then transferred
Parwana,
us.
Could, what was that image? People were having a pancart or saying "Welcome to Hell," or
they saw that the new bus has just arrived, and on the windows and on the car they were knocking and were saying "Welcome to Hell." Mm. It was very shocking, all for me and my siblings, thinking that what we are going to face with, mm-hmm. because we didn't know any imagination of how Moria is. We knew that, we heard something about it, but we didn't know, we didn't have any photo, and we didn't, not many resources were existed in the internet when we Googled about the name. And after that, in the reception center, we saw the police, that they took all our stuffs, and then they awaited us for many hours. So Moria is, as you know, was the notoriously worst and biggest, you know, refugee camp that was more than the number that they were expected to keep the refugees inside. And so, you know, life there was not a normal life. It was totally terrible. It was a big traumatization. In fact, it was a re-traumatization, because we already faced a trauma by passing the border of Greece and passing the rough sea and facing the whale of the violation of police. And then it was another re-traumatization to be in the camp for many months, or maybe for some people for 1 year, and without being aware of how long we were going to keep. And the only thing that I can say, that even for the prisoners, that they get kept in the prison, at the beginning they are told that how long are they going to stay in that prison. But in the camps it's not like this. You don't know when are you going to get released of that camp. And this is the beginning of the shock for all the refugees, that they get transferred to the camps.
And how was your relationship with the authorities there?
I can say that we didn't have a connection with the authorities. The only thing that was, that in the first step we had to, you know, we had to face all the challenges and just to provide the first basic needs that we had by any connection that we could get inside of the camp. And after a while, you know, by building the tent, for instance, we didn't know how to get a shelter. And then they say that you can get a tent and you can build it in the olive tree zone. There was a zone on that side, close in a, I can say, in a jungle, you know, place. So, and after that, we were told that we can get the food, but the food line was, it was taken for I can say 4 hours or 3 hours, and it was the same for everyone, and not even exception for the, you know, pregnant women or vulnerable people. However, most of them, that they came to the Moria, they had psychological or physical problems. And then, what was the next part of your question?
Well, the next part is, in fact, could you leave the camp? And did you have any kind of relationship with the local population?
That's a very insightful question. I can say that in the beginning, we had the buses, and for the buses we had to pay, and the camp was almost half an hour far from the center. The local people, I can say that they didn't know where is Moria camp. They were just passing, and while passing the camp, they were only able to see the wall and some containers, but they were not aware of, you know, hundreds of tents beyond those walls and those containers. So even the local people, that they were only, you know, some kilometers far from the camp, they were not able to understand how the situation looks like. And you know, regarding your question about the communication, and I can say that we didn't have you know, strong communication. We were not even able to communicate with them because we were 24 hours kept inside of the camp and following our asylum procedure.
You couldn't leave, in fact.
We were able to leave, yeah, but we were not able to leave the island.
Yeah.
We were not able to leave the island and to go to the mainland. You know, that means there was a border for us from the island to the mainland. And there was a long procedure to pass and to be able to have this freedom of movement to move on the mainland.
Parwana, one thing I ask myself in this situation that we have briefly described, how did you find the energy and the imagination to start writing and in fact communicating with the world? And how was it possible technically to do that? I mean, yeah.
First of all, I can say that I am traumatized and I can fully accept and I cannot declare that I don't have depression, because all those people that they are kept inside of the camp, being for 2 years or more than that and facing all sorts of problems, it is not unexpected to not face depression. They have a very hidden and long-term depression. It is true because according to psychologists, also the people that they kept far from the local community and also behind the walls and with less access to the basic needs of their daily life, they face this psychological problems. And for me, it was a way to reduce those pressures that I was facing. Writing was a weapon and a very strong instrument for me to, maybe I should not use this word, but to just be able to reduce all those pressures that I was suffering from. It was a way to feel that I'm connected with the world, and it really didn't matter for me how many people were going to read my words, but it was very important for me to see that I have a connection with the world outside, because it was an exclusion. Well, saying exclusion, that means that you need to fight for that to get it and to have it. Maybe we didn't need to fight if the system wouldn't put us under that condition, but we were, because we were, you know, following only the ways to be able to communicate with the local community, to communicate with the European communities and Central European communities, and it was really hard because you're just kept, you only see the people that they had the same history, you only are in communication with the people that they have the same, you know, they face the same challenges and pass the borders. But for me, when I met the first few people that they read my writings and they told me that we need, and Europe needs, Europeans needs your writings and the true stories and the facts and this stories that you're writing about the refugees inside of the camp, and the reflection that you are giving us from the life being in the camp. But I would never expect being in Europe and facing the condition that even Europeans are not aware of what we were living in. Because for me, back in Afghanistan, Europe was a mother of freedom. And I was saying that everybody at least has the right to express themselves. And I was writing anonymously because I didn't want to put the asylum apply of my family in danger.
Professor Desmet, Parwana thought that Europe was the island of freedom when she was in Afghanistan, but you as a specialist in law, human rights, how can we explain that Europe has produced that kind of camps like Moria, where people are like in a black hole, never knowing when they will get out? I mean, yeah.
Yeah, I think indeed if we hear your experience, it's a terrible situation, what is happening in Greece, also in other zones of transit in the camps, also in Brussels, in Calais. We see everywhere in Europe terrible situations of how people are being received. And there is a very stark contrast in the first place between the legal rules, and there is a procedures and a reception conditions directive which says that all people that apply for asylum, they should have adequate reception conditions. But then we see that what is happening on the ground is completely something else.
And why is that so?
If we look, you know, there are different explanations sometimes given, as some people say, for you, it's a matter of implementation, and we have the laws, we have to implement it, and that's maybe the most optimistic vision. Other people also related to identity questions, underlying issues of discrimination and so on, and that keep permitting
it's a way to keep people out.
To keep...
Yeah. Not apply the law, in fact. Yeah.
People have also said, you know, it's a way to deter more people from coming, you know, if we increase the reception conditions and so on, that it may have, some politicians say, you know, that it would otherwise attract more people, but that's not the issue here, and everybody who applies for asylum has the right to decent reception conditions, has the right that their claim is being heard and decently processed. And so we see a very stark contrast between what is happening on the ground, between the laws on migration, and then even more so between with the human rights that all people have, should be respected. And in that sense, migration law is a very grim area sometimes, you know, because you have all these nice policies and laws on paper, and then what is happening on the ground is sometimes, and I think, you know, we will also talk about positive experiences of solidarity and so on, but there are very grim experiences as well, and very grim situations on the European continent.
Before we go to Ghent, I would still like to annoy you with a more general proposition, and that is that maybe is migration not an issue where you have two strong dynamics who collide in a way with each other? The right of individual human beings to improve their life and to do whatever it takes to do that, and on the other hand, societies, I would not say the right or the reality of societies and states to say, well, but we will define who can be a citizen in this state. And that these are the two dynamics that in a way collide or fighting with each other. Is that a fruitful way to look at it, or Professor Bhabha?
I think, yes, you're right. It is a fruitful way to look at it. But I think that states realized, certainly after World War II, that the prerogative of deciding who gets to enter your country or not cannot apply to people who are fleeing for their lives because their own country has turned against them. And so that's where the refugee exception, if you like, comes in. So it's one thing to say we can decide who can be a citizen, and that is a prerogative of every country to decide to have its own rules, you know, how many years, or whether you need, you know, blood or descent or whatever, there are different rules for acquiring citizenship. It's another matter to say that somebody whose life is in danger should not have access to safety on your territory. And that's, if you like, the big exception that refugee law and our current system has made. So yes, you're right. On the one hand, there are people, everybody has the right to kind of preserve their life and their freedom. And on the other hand, states have a right to regulate their borders and to regulate who becomes a citizen. But states have agreed themselves to qualify that right by allowing people to enter their territory to seek protection from life-threatening danger. And so that's where the refugee provision comes in. And I just want to say one thing to follow on from that very moving account of Moria. Imagine if Afghans, like you, Parin, had not had to go, I don't know how you got to Moria, but probably it was a very uncomfortable journey, and then to arrive in this place where you're being welcomed to hell. I mean, what a nightmare after having to leave your country. Imagine if instead of that, you had what the Ukrainians are having, and nobody wishes, you know, this situation, this terrible situation on the Ukrainians. But imagine if you'd had a situation where Europe said, we know what's happened in Afghanistan. We know that there are still landmines. We know that this country has been at war for 30 years. We know that Western powers have contributed to enormous instability. We know that there are forces like the Taliban who are very dangerous. And so we're going to admit you freely, and you can come to Europe. And in the case, you know, you can come, say, for 3 years. And your children can go to school, and you can use the health service, and you're welcome, because we realize what you're fleeing. You wouldn't have had to stay in Moria. You wouldn't have had to go through a torturous asylum procedure. You wouldn't have had to be humiliated, you know, living in the, I've been to that camp several times, to that, in the mud, and, you know, the queues for water, queues to go to the bathroom, queues for food, you know, inadequate health care. You wouldn't have had to do that. So
Professor, how do you explain that huge difference? Because the question has been posed also in Belgium this week, that apparently there's a huge solidarity towards Ukrainian refugees, but we have not seen the same attitude, for instance, to the Afghan people.
I think it's a schizophrenia of the West, to be honest. On one hand, they say that you have freedom and you have the right to live and all these things, but on the other hand, you have to be part of a gang. So if you want to enter Europe and you want to have these things, or the West, you have to be part of this gang. And I think that's the big problem.
What gang do you mean, Bilal?
I am saying a gang, but it could also be citizenship. It's actually be part of a certain group of people. If you look at Europe, you know, you have to be European, you have to have blue eyes, you have to have blonde hair. That's actually also what we're seeing right now. You know, you have these things that they have a cultural history that they share, and it's actually based on these things. And if you look what's happening in Belgium or other countries, it's more nationalism that's coming up. So it's actually also the combination of this nationalism that we see coming up again and this history that we already had, because it's not something new we are seeing here now. Mm-hmm. So it's always been like this, colonization, the people are trying to come here because it's better there. They actually have all the resources, but they're not managing in themselves. So they're actually not being rich, they're being poor, and we're seeing the same things happening again. So I think...
How are you then saying, Bilal, it's in fact racism, or how?
Well, if you have a certain system, which in a structure, some people get ahead and some people don't get ahead because of their background, their religion, whatever, then it's, of course, it's racism. I think racism is a big part of this new capitalism that we have.
I try to be positive, Bilal. Could it also be that, in a way, Ukraine is the perfect storm? We have been prepared mentally through information channels that the war might come. And then it came. And then people started flying. But while in general, people are not as informed about Afghanistan. I'm not looking for excuses, but I try to look for a softer explanation.
Actually, if you see people here, they probably know about Yemen, they probably know about Palestine, they probably know about Kashmir. Mm-hmm. But it's the way the media actually portrays all these things that we have issues. Some issues get more attention, they get more time, in the newspaper, on the radios, on the television. Mm-hmm. So if people talk about more it, and I think it's about crystallizing public opinion, you know, if you can get a certain opinion and you can guide it through a way, then you always will have more attention. But on the other hand, people are also selling arms in Afghanistan. They're getting gas, they're getting certain stuff from there that they're getting here. So it's a bit hypocrite to talk about these things. Even in Yemen, they're not actually helping the Yemenis, because Saudi Arabia sells them oil, and there's trades that they have. So there is much going on globally in economical terms that we actually don't know about.
Yeah.
And now we're looking at Ukraine, which will probably go over and won't remember it like all the other stuff we're doing.
So what you're saying, apart from indeed certain racism, you also say indeed people don't know a lot of stuff. And our media
don't want to know.
Yeah. Professor Desmet, you wanted to come in or no?
Yeah, but just to come in, it is a historic difference. We had a reception crisis, I think, before the Ukrainian people had to flee their country, where the Belgian state had been condemned by a tribunal for not giving people who registered, because not everybody could register their application for international protection. Mm-hmm. So especially single men, they could not register their application, so they had no access to reception, they had to sleep on the streets. So that was just, you know, even in the beginning of this week still, Belgium has been condemned by a tribunal for this lack of reception. And then, we cannot but notice that now with people of Ukraine coming, that suddenly a lot more seems to be possible than was the case a bit before. So it's a very big difference and you know, that there's no differences based on nationality that are allowed, you know, in the Refugee Convention or any other law on reception conditions or asylum.
Yeah.
Can I just jump in for 1 second?
Yes. Yes.
I just want to say something which is maybe controversial, but it's not always that the local people are hostile. In Moria, in the beginning of the Syrian crisis, I think this was before large numbers of Afghans were arriving, but in the beginning of the Syrian crisis, actually the local people rushed to the shore, and for actually quite a long period, I would say local people, not the NGOs, but the local people on the island were incredibly generous. And then in my view, having gone and spoken to people, it's the failure to resettle, it's the failure to support the local people that then leads to resentment. So I agree that people don't know enough, don't want to know. But when tragedy hits their doorstep, very often their first response is a compassionate, generous one of solidarity. But you can't sustain that solidarity if you have no services, if your hospital is overcrowded, if there's rubbish everywhere, if, you know, you're worried about the safety of your children. So I think that's the key thing. And I think that's where this EU response in the Ukrainian context is so important, because it's going to make it easier for Poles and for Hungarians and for Belgians to support the refugees, because they are legal, they can work. They don't need to depend on the charity. They don't need to hide. They don't need to sleep on the street. And so it'll make it easier for ordinary people to be generous. And that's what should have happened with the Syrians. That's what should have happened with the Afghans.
You say because it is being well managed from the top and there's money.
And they're anticipating the predictable needs. So we have 1 million. We probably have 2 million Ukrainians in
Europe. But of course, this depends on the political will to do so. This depends on the political will to do so. Yeah, yeah. Okay, now I think we would go to our city. And we have tried to describe a little bit in just half an hour this global migration situation. But what can a city of like Ghent, 250,000 inhabitants, do? I have understood that when it comes to social issues, sometimes Ghent does things that other cities don't do. I saw you nodding, Professor Desmet, but maybe the only one who has not spoken is Astrid. So, does this ring a bell if I say that, when it comes to social rights, Ghent sometimes does things that other cities don't do? Do you understand what I say?
I think we can say that, yes.
Yeah. Could you elaborate on that? Yeah.
But maybe I can elaborate. Maybe I can first react on the Ukraine versus other refugees.
Yes.
Because I was thinking about that a lot in the past few days, especially because of media coverage that was so different when compared to like 2015, for example. Also, Europe's response is completely different. But then when I come to the generosity, if I can use your words, Professor, the generosity of the people, of local people, I can see a similarity, especially in Ghent. Mm-hmm. When I look at what happened in 2015 in Ghent, the civil organizations, civil society organizations in Ghent, I think also the local authorities, what we did together to manage this asylum crisis in 2015, it's similar to what is happening now on a broader level, I think, to the Ukrainian people.
Yeah.
And that's a good thing, I think. It's not because they get a good welcome.
So you're saying the city of Ghent, the organized citizens, are in a way reacting in the same way now as they did 6 years ago. Yeah.
Well, in a similar way, I think the solidarity,
that
we see right now with the Ukrainian refugees, it was not absent when the refugees were Syrians or Afghans.
Yeah, yeah.
There was a similar solidarity in Ghent and among the residents of Ghent,
yes,
I believe.
In spite of this political reception on the European level being very different, but you say Ghent, in a way, reacted more or less the same.
I think we did. I think the solidarity is there in a similar way, and I think I can say that this has to do with both the solidarity among the residents, or Ghent residents themselves, or civil society organizations, but also the collaboration between local authorities and civil society organizations. We get together and we think about, okay, how are we going to manage this? That's what we did in 2015, mm-hmm. when we had lots of refugees from Syria. Mm-hmm. And that's what we are also going to do right now with lots of refugees from Ukraine.
Bilal, you agree that yes. in tandem, the citizens, organized citizens, and
I think it's in the DNA of the people of Ghent to be generous and to always get together and solve things in a different way, which I totally like. But there is also like a bittersweet thing in the back, you know, that it's not the same, you know. If you look, because the community, the Muslim community, let's say, there is a difference, you know, because they see all of these other things happening, and this time it's totally different, you know. It's not, they're not like a problem, you know. There's like even Vlaams Belang or NVA, you know. Everybody's like in on it. It's like a collective.
The Ukrainian flag on the cathedral.
Which makes you think about it in a different way, because you see a total different, let's call it propaganda. You know, it's a total different way. Of course, these people need help. You know, they're fleeing. It's not about these people. You know, it's just the way that it's being portrayed. It creates a very weird feeling for people with migration background, because, you know, you were asking before to her, like, how did it feel to come from Afghanistan, and how do you feel? Well, if you ask me, I'm third generation, and there's even fourth generation and fifth generation here, and we also don't feel welcome sometimes. Mm-hmm. And this sometimes I'm minimizing it, actually.
Yeah.
So it's not just about migration coming, it's about what migration is already here. And this migration that is here, I'm one of these people, and we have it difficult, you know. If you look at Belgium, the situation of Belgium, let's say Ghent is a bit better. Belgium scores is one of the worst in the class of Europe, you know, which is, for me, very weird. If you look housing, if you look at employment, if you look at unions, universities, if you go all to these things, and then you have migrants coming here in a situation where it's already very difficult, mm-hmm. then it's not about who's coming here, who's already here, and what are we doing about this. Mm-hmm. So you have to talk about different things, because it's all linked to one another. We cannot take one aspect of a global thing, because today we're talking about global citizenship. Mm-hmm. Then you have to also talk about the global impact, and how are we going to do it globally, and how are all these structures connected. And it becomes very difficult. Then you have politics, you know, because you're also fluctuating with the politics. The colors change every 6 years in the city. So you have to change with the time. So there's no thing that we can say, oh, in 20 years or 30 years, we're going to have this kind of policy. We always try. It's a good thing. But it's very difficult to work within these terms. So, you know, for us as an NGO that works out of these things, we always try to be not colorful. You know, we don't work with colors. We try to think about 10 years, 20 years, how are we going to sort different things. And for us as an organization, we focus mainly on propaganda. So we try to be a production house. We try to have like writers. We're trying to build something like this so we can influence the imagery of people, because that's what's happening right now. We have the mainstream media using all this imagery, but there is no counter media. You know, even if you look at it, it's an alternative. They don't have the same means. They don't have the same money. They don't have the same quality. So I think to do something about this situation, I think you have to have all these other stories also getting the attention. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I think you should get more attention for everyone.
Yeah. Okay. Astrid, so we were at these social rights, and maybe Ellen can also come into it, because I think you have studied this. Again, maybe first we get the objective view.
No.
Yes.
But no, so indeed we carried out a study which was actually for the Moving Cities map. So it's an initiative that tries to identify inspiring policies at the local level, because what we see across Europe is that everywhere the national administration and governments are often quite reluctant or have kind of negative discourse around migration, that we have seen in Europe, but also in the United States, even more with the sanctuary cities and so on, that cities are taking a key role there, and that the importance of local leadership and alliances between cities, between the city and the civil society, and the city society, you could say, at the local level, also international alliances, and that cities have, you know, taken up the defense of the rights of migrants, that they have taken steps there, sometimes going against or beyond what the national government
could you
is
make that
to
concrete
do.
What where do they go beyond then these cities,
for instance, sometimes in certain cities also in the United States, for instance, they have said from, okay, we will not report irregular migrants, we will not, and it's a sanctuary city, if you don't have a residence right, you are welcome here anyway. In the city of Ghent, what we found also in the research is that they already start accompanying asylum seekers before they are recognized, so also already starting a process of, you know, getting to know the people of Ghent, feeling more welcome, and working towards inclusion, not waiting, being in the limbo until your asylum application is recognized, but already starting from the beginning with policies, also going towards young people, and the project Ankerkracht Refu Interim, an inspiring project on offering volunteering, linking volunteers with a refugee background to other organizations. So you have a lot of inspiring practices at the local level that foster or that aim to foster cohesion and inclusion.
Astrid, what can Ghent do on the social level that other cities don't do?
Well, I think Ellen, from an objective point of view, already pointed out some important things. But maybe to get back to Bilal, he's right. And what I said about solidarity being there in 2015 and today, I don't want to romanticize this, because it's not... We never have to take this for granted. It's something we have to work on and continue to work on. And I think working on integration from day one, as we like to say it in Ghent, is an important aspect. Integration meaning a two-way street, meaning newcomers arriving in Ghent and trying to learn the language, getting to know the city and how the city works, but also former city residents getting to know the refugees, organizations getting to know the refugees, like when they do voluntary work through organizations such as Refu Interim. So we try to work on that integration as a local authority together with civil society organizations from day one. This is very important. But I think there's also a more structural policy of trying to fight prejudice against people with different backgrounds, of fighting racism, fighting discrimination, which is important for refugees, but it's also important for second, third, fourth generation people from Ghent with migration background. For example, we work on correspondence testings. We did that years ago as the first city ever in Belgium. We did correspondence testings when people try to hire, find housing. So we did correspondence testings to check if you get a different, you get treated
reaction
differently if you have
depending
a migration background
depending
on your name. We did this as well in work. So we are trying to fight racism and discrimination on a structural level by implementing these policies. Yeah. And I think both are important.
Is it possible for a city to give political rights to migrants that do not really exist on the national level?
I think so. What we try to do, you know, you have, because you have different, you know, you're talking about migration, asylum seekers, there's like a lot of different definitions of all these kind of people. But if you talk about people without legitimate papers to stay in Belgium, I think you can give them warmth, you know, you can, like Ghent does that, there's a very good integration, you can go to in Ghent, and they help you with a lot of things, even if you don't have the papers. So I think to get information is a very good thing, to give them housing, which is very difficult. Ghent has very big issues with this, you know, there's not enough space. So I think as a city, there's a lot of empty housing. You could give them housing and just kind of, how do you say, manage that. So warmth, housing, and if you give this, I think people will already be able to grow from this. Like she also said before, you know, she came there, she was not welcomed. Mm-hmm. That's the first thing she said, you know, being welcome. And I think Ghent does that very well. So if we could do that even more, to make them feel welcome and give this warmth. I think it's a very romanticizing thing, but I think it's the basic thing that we need.
Yeah, but this is not really political rights. I mean, yeah.
Somehow it is, because if you go to an institution and you don't have the right paper, they're not able to help you. Mm-hmm. So if you don't have anything and you go to an institution and they do help you without any paper, it is a right, I think. For example, in Ghent, you have different places where you can get food, and the Kras heet dat. It's called Kras, and Kras, some people are able to get the food, some people not, because they have different statuten. I don't know how to say that. Statuses. So, but there are places where you can get food, it doesn't matter who you are.
Whether you have papers or not.
Yeah, it's anonymous. Yeah. So, you know, if you would have more of these anonymous places where you can just go get your food, get a shower, and don't need to have any registration or, you know, somebody telling you what to do, that you have these open spaces where you can go, which is not easy, you know, because all these people, like you said, they have, some have traumas, some have a family, some, there are many situations, but I think we should create these open spaces where they can come and sit, and we're actually trying to do this soon, so...
Yes, I think that's exactly what we try to do in Ghent when it comes to undocumented migrants. Our first task is to have correct information. We have a city service, info.migratie, it's called, where people also without documents can go to get informed on their legal status, what they can do in order to get a legal status or not. Also, we try to make sure that people can access the rights they do have, because it's not because a migrant has no documents that a migrant has no rights. Mm-hmm. They have the right to healthcare, children have the right to go to school, they have the right not to be exploited. They have the right to experience leisure activities in our city, so that's what we try to make sure as well, that they can have access to those rights.
Astrid, is this right, for instance, the right of children without papers to go to school, is this being applied in the whole of Flanders, in all communes, or how do you call that, cities or villages of Flanders? I don't know. I can imagine where you have a very right-wing city government or council, that it's not so self-evident, but I'm looking to all of you, whether we do know this.
I never did a comparison between all local governments in Flanders, but I can imagine that not every city or not every local government gives free food at schools for children with who live in undocumented families. Free bus tickets, for example, is also a way we try to make sure that people without documents can get their children to school. I know that, for example, medical cards, which is very important for people without documents, we try to get those to those people in a very proactive way. That's a choice we make, and I believe it, not every city in Flanders makes that choice. But I don't know in detail.
I asked the question because I happen to have made a little report on Isegem. That's the place where I come from, long time ago. And I found out that the employers really they are begging for immigration. We don't have enough people anymore. It has been impossible to be unemployed in Isichem for the last 30 years, and now it's even worse. So they say we need migration from Africa, from Asia. But the biggest party in Isichem is Vlaams Belang. So you don't have a lot of migrants there. But so I have the feeling that sometimes in some communes of Flanders, it's very paradoxical that you have these different tendencies, that the economic tissue is saying, oh, we want more migration. And then politically, you have the opposite.
Yeah. But in numbers, you know, Belgium is a very old country. If you look in numbers, so a lot of white people are going to die soon. They need to be replaced.
You're smiling.
They need to be replaced. And because just making some fun. So they need to be replaced. And it's just logic, you know. If you don't create enough babies, after a while, you will have problems with your economy. And migration is a solution, and it has been proven. You know, even if you look at Germany, they say we're Schaffendust. They had 1 million migrants that they said come into our country, and if you look at their numbers right now, it's quite okay. So it.
But
it's
how,
Bilal,
do you?
You're going to end up in a Vlaams Belang video about omvolking. You know this, right?
I don't mind.
I just wonder, and I. In preparing this, I listened to a video of you, Professor Bhabha, where you spoke about the cosmopolitan spirit. That is also one of the things that should be more developed. That goes the opposite direction of nationalism in a way to have this more open attitude of people. Maybe in Ghent it's not such a problem. I have met several times people coming from Waregem or wherever, and they said, oh, it's much better here. So I think what you referred to in the beginning, Astrid, is a bit of this cosmopolitan spirit. Maybe it's a huge word, it's a big word. Maybe there are other words to describe a kind of openness in a society, in a community, towards people coming from another place.
I'm not really thinking about open words. I'm thinking about something else I wanted to say that,
yes,
linking also with
say
political
it.
Rights. I will say it. Not so nicely as with a nice quote, but you have these opportunities for cities to be social, to be warming and so on. But of course, the fundamental tension that we have today is that it's still the federal level deciding on the entry and the residence. And we saw that also with the initiative of Gent zonder Grenzen, supported by the city of Ghent, that they say, hey, we want to welcome refugees, we want to resettle refugees. But that is decided at this moment at the federal level. So there, I think we could take inspiration from, for instance, resettlement programs in Canada, in the UK, where private groups of citizens, supported often by the city as well, can sponsor refugees to be resettled from other countries. In addition, you know, not within the quota of the states to resettle refugees, but in addition, and that opens up, you know, not only the possibilities of being welcoming and so on towards the people that get here, but also providing safe and legal pathways to prevent what Parwana and many others had to go through. And there we are at this moment stuck with the legal situation as it is. Because
that is not allowed in Belgium. Yeah.
That is not allowed, but it's not that it could not be allowed. I mean, that's just a matter of legal change. Mm.
Yes, we lit after the big fire in Moria. We literally to the federal government to receive a number of people from Moria, but it didn't happen. It didn't happen because the federal government didn't go through with it. Mm. So I'm very interested in getting to know projects from. I don't know, where was it in the US or?
Yeah, and in Canada, they're trying also to promote this private and community sponsorship of resettlement, offering also global advice to others.
That, Professor Bhabha, because.
Yes, I'm sorry, I lost the line. Absolutely. I would just say two things. First, I think the role of cities is critical. And I think that where you say that, you know, Ghent offered to take people from Moria and the federal government, didn't act on it. I think that dynamic is a really important one to promote, that cities, municipalities are now at the forefront often of pushing the federal government, their federal governments, to do the right thing. So more and more cities, I think, are working together. We have this very much during the Trump administration in this country, in the US, where cities were giving, as we were saying before, giving driver's licenses to people who are implemented. Say, you are a part of our community. You may not have a legal identity for central government, for the immigration authorities, but for the purposes of New York City or New Haven or whatever city it is, LA, you can use this driver's license as an identity document. So that's the first point. And the second point is that this, you know, idea that it's a partnership between the public, if you like, and the state. So the Canada model is a sponsorship model, which is that you, as a group of individuals, I don't think you have to be citizens, as a group of legal residents, you might be a book club or a biking club, or people go to the same exercise class, or parents, you know, of kids in the same school, you, five of you, I think, or seven, can get together and commit a certain amount of money, not enormous, but I mean, maybe $1,000 a year or something. I forget the exact. And you commit to supporting a refugee for a year. And so that doesn't necessarily mean you commit a certain amount of money and certain services, like I will help them to open a bank account. I will help the children learn English, you know, go twice a week to help them with homework. I will introduce people to how to go to the register, to the, you know, the health clinic, etc. And so it's a way in which the government then gets, you know, screened in refugees from UNHCR, from the refugee authorities. And then the population who has sponsored become the sponsor, this group, let's say this biking group in Ghent becomes a sponsor for a refugee. And so they accompany the refugee for a year. And then at the end of the year, it's over. And of course, many of those relationships last longer, but the formal commitment is for 1 year.
Yeah, but that is not allowed in Belgium. No?
Not at the level of residence rights. Yeah. When people are here, then these forms of sponsorship.
Of course.
Then it
exists,
exactly, but it's more happens. About, yeah. You know, in Canada it can be used to reset.
I think this is one of the biggest problems that we have in Greece. We are struggling and we are putting out our resistance in order to address the problems, not to the local community, but also to the Central European population as well. You know, even in Greece, the solidarity of the local community with refugees is becoming a crime. I don't know how much are you aware, but the local people that they were going to help, some of the refugees in Everest part, they were getting, they went to the, you know, detention in order to ask if they are smugglers working and, you know, helping refugees to come to Greece or no. And this is also what we always ask the European states and also the Central European people, not only the local community in Greece, to know about the condition of refugees and margins of Europe more, because what the people in the condition of the refugees is in a term that they don't have, as long as they don't have this freedom of movement, they are trying to use all the possible ways in order to come to the center of the Europe, and then they know that they are in Europe. And also it's another way to also for the people in the center of Europe to put the Greek government under more pressures in order to give and provide these documents for the refugees and to give them the possibility to move in where they can have decent housing, decent jobs, and right to healthcare, education, and basic social services.
Thank you, Parwana. So we said that there would be some space for some questions or remarks from you. We still have 10 minutes. Yes?
You come here. thank you so much for inviting me here. It's a pleasure for me. I'm a new arrival here to Belgium. I just came here last week. I'm from Afghanistan. So I just want to ask a question from Ms. Professor, Mrs. Professor. My answer will be yes or no. Okay, I don't need any more explanation. Because when you were talking about Afghan refugees, I became so emotional. So I wanted to ask you questions before you call us and ask us for any questions. So have you ever think about the Afghan refugees before, how do they cross the borders of Bulgaria? I really think Mr. Maria, she represented about the Afghan refugee very well, but she's a girl. Do you know how Afghan boys crossing the border of Bulgaria and Greece? When we were coming from Turkey to Bulgaria, as an Afghan refugee, I was beaten by dogs. I was bare-chested. Everything was taken out from me. So there was snow there on the borders. They beat me with the dogs, and then they took everything from me, shoes, clothes, everything. But thank God we had a lighter, and the lighter survived us. So they returned back and deported back to the Turkish territory. We went back there for about 12 kilometers barefooted in the jungles with the torrents. So I just want to ask you the question, are you racist or no? Just yes or no. Are you racist or no? Can you answer me, please? The refugee agency.
But the question is
who's the, is it for me?
Who is
that's from you. The question is representing to her.
Yes.
Are you racist or no?
Whether the professor is.
Yeah. You are all the refugee agency and the European community. Are you racist or no?
Yes. She's a professor from Harvard.
I will explain it later. I just need yes or no questions. Yes or no answer.
Whether European agencies are racist?
Refugee agency and the European unions. Because, you know, just one thing.
Yeah, Afghans, okay. But your question is clear now.
Yes.
So, your question is clear. So, okay. I don't know if so he just arrived in Ghent. He had very bad experiences crossing, coming into Europe. And so his question is, what do you think that the European Union is racist? Yeah. And the question is for you, Mr. Professor Bhabha.
Yeah. Yes. So first of all, it's horrifying to hear your experience. And it's a disgraceful. And I hope that you will talk about this and the people who did this to you will get punished, because it is absolutely shameful behavior. A gross violation of human rights, and people who behave in that way should not only lose their jobs, but they should be charged with a criminal offense. That's brutal. I think that border control is overwhelmingly racist in the way it's operated. Not that there aren't some good individuals trying to do the right thing, not that there aren't occasions on which people, you know, go as far as they can, but as European border controls operate, I think, unfortunately, we have to say at this point, they are deeply, deeply racist.
Okay, that's a clear answer. Are there other people who want to come in? No? Yes, yeah.
I don't know if I have a clear question, but I think Bilal also initiated a discussion about it. I feel like the debate about migration, asylum seekers, it's often, or the terminology is often very vague and swapped. And so maybe one question would be about asylum seekers, as others would be about migrants or people with migrant backgrounds. But the situation of people that are denied asylum and that are still in Europe or in other countries. I think maybe it's because it's so difficult to get out of that it's kind of like avoided even by experts or by politicians or in debates as this. I'm not saying you're actively trying to avoid the topic, but I feel like maybe it's just so difficult to find or to propose a solution for people in that situation that it's just not discussed. And I'm kind of just throwing this out there. It's not really a question, but maybe.
So you're talking about people who applied for asylum but were denied asylum and then just now remain here and are in a kind of legal vacuum.
Limbo.
Yes. I would like to answer. It's not because maybe I want to avoid it, but these people, because we as an organization, we follow a lot of these families. And mostly they don't want to be talked about, so that's the main thing. They try to avoid everything. Their children go to school. There was something before also about this. It's a very difficult situation. For example, we had a situation where the children go to school, the parents have no job, these kids go on a trip with the school, so they don't have the money to go on the trip. So there is one thing that, you know, you have this these people that don't have any papers, but then you have these situations. You know, so we as an organization try to solve these situations, and we're not much worried about the legality of things, you know, to get them a housing, to get them clothes, to get them all these things. So it's a very difficult question because these people don't want to be talked about. That's my feeling that I have, but they should be talked about. But from the moment these people come into the lights, or how do you say in the limelight, they become, for them it becomes a problem, so they like to stay away from the lights.
I think you actually initiated a little bit of the mentioning of these situations. And I can understand politically, it's very hard, even locally, to do something about something that's decided on a federal level. And I wonder maybe if the law provides any option for participating in society and in a permanent way, in a sustainable way for these people.
Yeah, the option that is most known or talked about is, I think, what's called the 9 bis, the humanitarian regularization, but that's a very opaque and long and costly procedure, which is a discretionary competence of the Secretary of State. So he decides, you know, based on criteria that are not even there. So that's a very vague procedure where at least I think one part of a solution is that certain categories should get out of that procedure, should get a residence right, and this has been announced now, for instance, for stateless persons who cannot return, for parents of children who have an international protection status. Another way, I think, because at the moment, you know, politically, or if we read the policy note of the Secretary of State, and his policy intentions seem to be that this humanitarian regularization will remain a discretionary competence at the moment, or that's what he says in his policy note. Maybe to also try to move things at a procedural level, at least, as there was in the legislative proposal from citizens, and to implement this right to be heard, as we heard yesterday from Kati Verstappen, to try to, you know, improve the procedure of this humanitarian regularization. I think another thing that and that's a collective responsibility is also that you know, people that have no residence rights now, it doesn't mean that they can never access any residence right. And we only talk about often the humanitarian regularization, but there are other accesses to residence rights as well. At the moment, it's a problem that you cannot apply for work permits when you're a regular in the country, but you have other specific statuses that could also give a solution. And there I think we have a problem also of lack of adequate legal assistance, that sometimes people don't get a good look at their file, you know, and it's something also where we try to do a little bit with a legal clinic with students at the university to, you know, help people with that do not have documents to have a good look at their file and explore, are there any residence options, because maybe sometimes they also are and they haven't been explored because of a lack of adequate legal assistance. But at the federal level, it's a problem.
Astrid?
Yes, I wanted to react to that as well, because it's one thing not to have a solution. I think neither of us has the perfect solution to the problem you just described, but we certainly do not want to be silent about this group. Everything I said about what we, as local authorities, in cooperation with civil society organizations, we do for undocumented migrants, this accounts for this group as well. About we give them information, we try to make sure that they can access social rights such as education, leisure, health. But also we recently, last year, we started a project in Ghent called Opvang en Oriëntatie, which is like a shelter project, 24/7 shelter and orientation. And what do we mean with orientation? It's trying to find a way to either stay in Belgium in a durable manner and with a legal residence through a humanitarian residence, medical residence, maybe there's other options, or to find other options that are durable, migrating to another country where there are more perspectives, returning to a country of origin, if that's an option. So that's what we do. We offer 24/7 shelter, and we try to find a solution, a long-term solution. And a part of the people who are in this project are people who have formally applied, but have not not been granted residence.
Maybe to finish this, because we have to stop, that the labor market also could help. I don't know what will be the effect of the Ukraine situation, but yeah, I have the feeling that the way of talking about migration is changing in Western Europe. If you look to the new German government agreement, they call themselves now an immigration country. In the Dutch new government agreement, you also have a certain openness towards organized migration. And then, of course, you wonder, if there you have so many people who are already here, why don't you maybe try this instead of organizing more migration? But yeah, okay. So, Parwana, I think now the floor is yours. I don't know, everybody stays here and while Parwana brings the poems. Okay, we just stay together here. Yes, and we listen to you.
My own land. By the rising sun, our ancient Herat, a girl was born to a family, wishing for yet another boy. Having a girl was shameful, but mother was holy. In that city, patriarchy ruled and led, and education was every girl's thankless struggles. The baby was born butterfly, held in her sister's arms, a second virgin mother. She was born when the country was besieged by war, when East and West were spinning barbed wires around, and entry to foreign lands was called an invasion, but her family dared to cross. Today, in a foreign land, across valleys, mountains, and seas, I, butterfly, stand resistant, resolved, a migratory girl whose words shall reach thousands and conjure up the proud image of my homeland. Land of injured lilies and newborn babies born from young bellies, land of intense faces, volcanic movements, and fighting women. Land where homeless children vainly dream for a school. Land of people displaced as the world watches on screens. My homeland has natural power, snatched by greed and superpowers. Afghanistan was injured. Its soldiers fought endless wars. Thousands of innocent young souls were lost, yet we are much more than what you call Afghans. Always displaced, distressed, depressed, in troubles and disease. Afghanistan is the land of brave women without men, is the land of courageous men without army, land of courageous army without US forces, where each single Afghan takes a gun to defend themselves. Here I am with my pen. Thank you very much. Mr. Kalas, if you can present the photos, please. Thank you. This never-ending struggle, from east to west, from north to south, I call you. I call you to the world of war, where peace was the bright but died. I call you to our struggles, where girls are in the front lines. With one voice, I call you. I call you to our protest without a microphone. Behind these walls meet our bright eyes. I call you to the world of burning hearts, where feasts are raised and sails are up. I call you, I urge you, come with us, join in our struggles. We demand our rights, though threatened and afraid, but still we resist. We will not stop and will not be stopped. We are soldiers without armor. Our armor is our posters. We fight without swords. Our swords are our banners. Loud and clear, we are an army with no oars. Our legs are enough, our will is tough. We resist and will never stop. Thank you. There's always a time that simple sentences cannot describe your pains, your words, your feelings. But it's always a time to use the rhythm of your pains that refers a poem. In Moria 2019, when the first time I started understanding what does a poem mean, it was exactly the time that I noticed that by using some simple words, I constructed a new form of literature, literacy piece that is called poem, that was called poem by some of the readers. The name of poem is We Are Burning. It's not to mark the date, it's to raise the alarm. The fire has burned our schools. The fire has burned our hospitals. The fire has burned our dreams. We are burning. We search for your eyes. You have turned them away. You have hidden your faces. Who is the criminal? Not the fire, for sure. Who shall pay for the life of the baby burning? Who shall answer the mother, never to touch her child again? Who dares imagine the screams of the baby was crying, was crying. The baby was burning, a bundle of coal left behind. Where are those who cursed us, those afraid we threatened their wealth? Come on and see. Do you dare to look at the sun? Better avert your eyes. Hide and lock yourselves in your homes. We are silent so that you hear us. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Parwana. I think we have come to the end of our interaction or discussion or talk. I have to thank everybody. Professor Bhabha from afar, Bilal Abbas, Professor Desmet, Astrid De Bruycker and Parwana Amiri. Thank you very much and thank you for listening to us. Yeah.
Kom er weer snel even tussen. Eerst en vooral heel erg bedankt, ook John van Dalen, voor de moderatie op zich te nemen. Ik wil ook jullie graag uitnodigen. Binnen een kwartiertje beginnen wij de vertoning van de film De Zaak Samuel, kortfilm die Lara Staal gemaakt heeft, samen met onder andere Pascal Poissonnier, die daar zit. Dag Pascal. Ook een hele mooie film die ook een heel interessant licht werpt, schijnt op het regularisatievraagstuk. En we zouden natuurlijk de School of Resistance niet zijn. We zouden niet hier in NTGent in een theaterzaal staan. Moesten we ook niet kijken naar hoe kunst kan bijdragen aan dit publiek debat. Welke rol kunst kan vervullen om die maatschappelijke vraagstukken daar antwoorden op te voorzien.
Yes, so also to the people listening to us right now, so in English. What will happen now, after a short break for our audience to get some rest, we will come back into this place and watch also, the global audience can also watch it, The Case Samuel by the artist Lara Staal. And afterwards we will have a short but inspiring after talk with Parwana Amiri and Lara Staal coming in, zooming in from Germany, as I heard, on the power of art in the field that we're trying to talk about. So how can artists and art help with the topics we're creating?
Misschien ook nog heel kort, dat is dan voor het publiek hier live in de zaal. Die bar is intussen gesloten. Dat is omdat we nadien met de afbraak dat alles heel vlot zou gaan. Maar de bar boven daarentegen die is wel open. Dus het is 15 minuutjes, ga ik rustig even naar de toiletten. Maak gebruik van de tijd om een drankje te gaan halen. En dan zien we jullie graag ook nog terug. Ik geef nog heel kort het woord ook aan Marios Bellas, die nog een heel kort woordje gaat doen over de In My Name-campagne. Je hebt de posters alvast zien hangen, maar zodat je daar zeker ook nog eens alert van wordt gemaakt van hoe dat we onze stem ook als burgers kunnen gelden binnen dit vraagstuk.
Dankjewel. Are you in English or in Dutch? Oké. Okay. Thank you first to everyone for the conversation. I just briefly wanted to talk to you about In My Name, which is a civil law proposal started by the different collectives of people without papers in Belgium. Dus In My Name, een campagne van de verschillende collectieven van mensen zonder papieren in België. Het gaat om een manier van een wetsvoorstel inbrengen waar je 25.000 handtekeningen voor nodig hebt. Dat is ofwel met EID of It's Me. We hebben straks een tekenstandje daar waar dat kan. We hebben heel veel stemmen nodig daarvoor in Vlaanderen, dus we zijn op de goede plek. A civil law proposal from which we need 25.000 signatures, from which 14.500 in Flanders. And started by the different collectives. And the idea is to have clear and permanent regularization criteria for Belgium, because at this moment, as was mentioned before, it's completely unclear what you actually have to do to get your papers. Even if you have a very good file, let's say, it might still be that you are refused your permanent residency. Dus het kan zijn dat je met een heel goed dossier nog steeds geweigerd wordt om hier permanent te blijven. En daarom gaat dit wetsvoorstel erover om permanente en heldere regularisatiecriteria te hebben in België. Dus ik nodig jullie allemaal uiteraard uit om te tekenen en dit wetsvoorstel in het federale parlement op tafel te krijgen. So I invite you all to sign in my name at the stand there and help get this to the federal level. And I think in reflection of what was said earlier, it's a great way of seeing how the grassroots actually bottom-up is working with other different organizations, even on local levels, and pushing it to the national level. Dus het is echt een manier om vanuit de grassroots, vanuit de verschillende collectieven samen te werken met organisaties op een lokaal niveau en het uiteindelijk naar het nationale niveau te krijgen. Dank jullie wel voor jullie aandacht.
Mijn naam is Adam Kissegel. En ik ben hier om het verhaal van Samuel te vertellen. Ik ben een acteur. En vandaag leen ik mijn lichaam, mijn gevoelens en stem uit aan Samuel. Een 18-jarige jongen uit Eritrea die 2 jaar geleden naar Nederland kwam. Samuel spreekt met mijn stem. Maar terwijl ik Samuel ben, ben ik ook Haptom, Makele, Abil, Merhawit, Asmara en zoveel anderen. Mijn naam is Adam Kizekel, maar vandaag heb ik vele namen, vele gezichten en vele stemmen die wellicht niet gehoord zouden worden. Mijn naam is Samuel Emmanuel Sinai. Maar wat betekent de naam? Wat betekent de naam als ik bij iedere registratie in Italië een ander heb opgegeven? Wat betekent de naam als die door de verschillende instanties verkeerd geschreven, geïnterpreteerd en uitgesproken wordt? Wat betekent de naam op een dag als deze? Waarin ik de echte namen van mijn vrienden niet uit mag spreken, omdat wij bang zijn dat dat schade berokkent aan hun zaken. Wat betekent de naam in een zaak Samuel? Een zaak gebaseerd op talloze vergelijkbare zaken die ook liggen te verstoffen in allerlei lades, bureaus, gebouwen. Wat betekent de naam in een land als Eritrea, waar we geen achternamen hebben? Waar we de voornaam van onze vader als tweede naam gebruiken en de voornaam van onze grootvader als derde naam. En wat doe je met de naam in een land waarin jouw echte naam niet als naam wordt erkend?
Over die eerste scène. Het is een soort metafoor, een soort poëzie, dat idee van de naam. Omdat wie geeft je een naam? Wie hoort jouw naam? Wie begrijpt jouw naam? Wordt jouw naam erkend, niet erkend? Wissel je in je leven van namen? Heb je dat zelf besloten? Hebben andere mensen jou een andere naam gegeven?
Ook toen hij in Italië was, toen heeft iemand zijn naam geregistreerd. Maar toen was hij niet eens bij bewustzijn.
Dus die persoon heeft jouw naam bedacht, hè? Die heeft gewoon, die had geen idee, neem ik aan. Die heeft gewoon een naam moeten bedenken.
Leek er heel veel op.
Dus echt? Ja. Dat is wel interessant. Ja. Ja. En jij weet niet wie dat was. Jij hebt die daarna nooit ontmoet.
Nee, nooit.
Jongens, ik wilde jullie even vragen of jullie even zo naar dat bord willen kijken over de Europese Unie. En dan zie je dus welke landen horen bij de Europese Unie. Of jullie daar even naar willen kijken en of een van jullie dan op het knopje wil drukken zodat je het volkslied van de Europese Unie hoort.
Nu is Europa alleen die, deze kleur, hè?
Ja, dit is alles wat Europa is.
En dit niet? Of wel?
Dat niet.
Mijn naam is Samuel en ik ben net 18 jaar geworden, net meerderjarig. Maar voordat ik volwassen kan worden, moet ik mij terug herinneren hoe ik een mens moet zijn. En ik weet niet hoe je dat doet. Als de bruggen in de stad de daken boven je hoofd geworden zijn. Als je alleen kan eten wat een ander kan missen. Als je 4 jaar lang je moeder niet hebt gezien. Als je niet aan je reis kan denken zonder geschreeuw te horen. Als je 2 keer op een bootje moet stappen zonder te weten of de zee voorgoed je graf zal worden. Als je 18 maanden onder moet duiken om opnieuw een asielaanvraag te kunnen doen. Maanden van verveling. 18 maanden waarin de seizoenen niet lijken voorbij te gaan. Hoeveel je ook door het raam staart. Waarin het land waar je bent aangekomen, onder het voorwendsel interstatelijk vertrouwen, jou met alle macht probeert terug te sturen. waarin je op je 15e aan de straat wordt toevertrouwd. Ik ben 18 jaar geworden. En ik ben vergeten hoe ik een mens moet zijn.
Ja, we zijn wel in Europa. Dit is de white man's country. Goed. Het valt op dat het alleen maar dat is.
Resources.
Hier krijg je dan...
Ja, we hadden net over resources, olie.
Precies, ja. Wauw.
Wow.
Inderdaad, ja. Het is echt een boereiland.
Waar is dit in Europa?
Dat is een hele goede... Ik bedoel, er zijn er natuurlijk meerdere.
Ja.
Maar ik weet niet of er hier dan iets staat over... Nee, volgens mij niet waar dat dan zou moeten zijn. Maar dus het staat altijd in de zee, hè?
Wat staat in Rotterdam, van Nederland?
Het zou kunnen, ja.
Ik heb dit geschreven omdat ik vind dat we boos moeten zijn. Dat er reden is om boos te zijn. Dat we andere mensen dit aandoen. Maar dat het precies zo ontroerend is, dat het me zo raakt... en dat ik hoop dat het publiek ook raakt... dat ondanks al die dingen die wij doen in Europa met mensen die op de vlucht zijn... die veiligheid zoeken, mensen zoals jij... Als je ze ziet, denk je alleen maar, die wil je vasthouden. Die wil je verwelkomen, daar wil je mee praten. Die wil je naar school laten gaan, die wil je werken, daar wil je mee samenwerken. En dat precies zo, die realiteiten, die kloppen niet op elkaar. Ik weet dat jij dit nooit zou zeggen. En daarom laat ik Adam, maar eigenlijk Samuel, misschien wel Sami, aan het einde zeggen, ik zou dit...
Je zegt nu, mensen die denken niet, dit is het verhaal van jou.
Ja.
Maar hier is die leven voor mij. Dus
ja?
Die,
herken je hierin?
Ja, want twee keer in de boot.
Mm-hmm. Ja.
Ik heb ook die leven gehad. Maar je wil niet die verhaal van mij, maar mensen dat, dat ik ben met jullie zijn, toch?
Precies.
Niemand weet.
Precies.
Ja.
Ja.
Ik begrijp
me. Ja. Nee, dus het is natuurlijk op je zoek zien... dat jouw zus in de tekst zit. Dan mag je ook zeggen, ik wil dat niet. We hebben er ook lang over gepraat. Moet de zus erin en hoe? Maar er zit ook in dat je 18 maanden hebt moeten wachten... alsof jij die Dublin-conventie, zoals andere Dublin Brothers... en dat is in jouw geval niet zo geweest. Je hebt ook moeten wachten, maar om andere redenen.
Daarom
soms gebruik ik dingen van jouw vrienden en soms
ja,
dingen van jou.
Ik was 13 toen ik uit Eritrea vertrok. Via Soedan, de Sahara, Libië, ben ik de Middellandse Zee overgestoken. De route die wij Eritreërs nemen, wordt door onderzoeker de drie traps heel genoemd. Het staat bekend als een route waar smokkelaars goed geld verdienen. Iedereen die naar Libië vertrekt, weet dat ze zullen worden afgeperst en gekidnapt. Ook ik wist dat. Er is geen sprake van misleiding. Ik ben eerst naar Soedan vertrokken, waar mijn zus woonde. Ik bleef een aantal maanden bij haar. Het was een goede tijd. Maar ik zag geen vooruitzichten. Ik zag geen horizon. Ik zag geen toekomst. Dus ik vertrok. Ik maak contact en ik werd naar de Libisch-Soedanese grens gebracht door smokkelaars uit Khartoum. Die mij en andere vluchtelingen vertelden te wachten. Toen de Libiërs arriveerden, brachten ze ons naar een soort gevangenis. Daar worden we geacht onze families te bellen, die in zo'n kort mogelijke tijd het geldbedrag bij elkaar moeten krijgen. En die mishandelingen in de kampen daar. Ja, daar wil ik niet over. Wil ik niet aan denken. En het stopt pas als je het hebt betaald. Niet iedereen kan dat betalen. In nood heb ik mijn familie gebeld. Mijn zus is toen van Soedan naar mij toe gereisd. Zij is een jaar bij mij gebleven. En toen doodgegaan in een Libisch detentiekamp. Ik heb mijn zus niet kunnen begraven. Zij was mijn grote liefde. Zij bracht mij zoveel plezier. Toen zij doodging, ik kon niet begrijpen waarom. Waarom mijn zus? Waarom mijn zus? In mijn cultuur, als iemand doodgaat, moet je respect betuigen. Ik heb mijn zus niet kunnen begraven. 2 jaar heb ik in Libië vastgezeten. Iedere keer betaalde ik nieuwe smokkelaars, totdat ik naar het noorden werd gebracht en de Middellandse Zee op werd geduwd.
Soms is de realiteit erger dan je kan voorstellen. Dat had ik heel erg toen Savannah me dat schreef. Eerst dacht ik, ik kan dat niet opschrijven. Mensen denken dat dat niet echt is. Dat is zoveel
ja,
erge
dat
dingen.
Denk ik ook. Mensen denken dat het niet echt is.
Maar ik denk dat mensen wel snappen dat deze tekst gebaseerd is op echte verhalen.
Ja, er is een stukje, er staat, ik heb haar daar begraven en achtergelaten. En hier heb ik het een aantal keer met Sami over gehad. Hij heeft haar dus niet kunnen begraven.
Ja, dat heb ik me ook al bedacht.
Ja,
hij zat gevangen en zij is begraven.
Ja.
Dus als je iemand dood is,
ja,
gaat die smokkelaar komen, dan die mensen pakken.
Ja.
Dan nu nooit zie je die mensen.
Die zie
ja, maar je ziet dat is dood, man.
Ja.
Maar je gaat niet begraven.
Mm-hmm.
En uiteindelijk, toen we met zijn zaak bezig waren, dan is dus ook de vraag, waar is je zus in een interview? En er is gewoon helemaal geen bewijs. Hè? Er zijn geen bewijzen van dat ze is begraven ergens.
Dat ze bestaat,
dat ze er nu niet meer is. Er is nergens een registratiedocument. Iets wat ineens heel belangrijk wordt als je in Nederland probeert asiel aan te vragen.
Ja.
Nou,
oké.
Ja, ik begrijp het.
Ik kan zo uitkiezen waar je levensstandaard het beste is.
Het hoogste
Italië
is.
96, ja. Malta 86.
Nou, dan. Hoeveel is...
Duitsland 126.
Portugal.
Nederland is het hoogste.
Nederland is het hoogste van
ja,
allemaal?
Ja.
Meen je niet?
Ja, dat is wat ik tot nu toe gezien heb.
Wat?
Portugal. Waar is Portugal?
78.
Ja.
Kijk, het laagste van iedereen, of niet?
Griekenland was Cyprus 82.
Ja, laagste van iedereen. Durf ik te verder.
Griekenland okay, 73.
Griekenland en Portugal.
78. Griekenland nog lager.
Wauw. Terrible.
Sami?
Ja?
Heb je ooit bewust voor Nederland gekozen? Of had je ook net zo goed naar Zweden gekund?
Ja, toen was ik, weet ik, in Nederland. Toen was, ja, ik wil naar alle Europa.
Maakte niks uit.
Maakte niet uit, ja.
Nederland was toeval.
Ja.
Kijk naar mij. Nee, echt. Kijk naar mij. Ik sta hier voor u. Om mijn verhaal te vertellen. Ik heb een acteur nodig om dat te doen. Toen ik zonder mijn ouders iets te vertellen op mijn 13e de grens overstak, brak mijn hart. Maar ik wilde de militaire dienst niet in. Een wapen is niet iets moois. Het zijn geen bloemen die je presenteert. Er spuugt vuur uit. Waarom zou een mens met gezond verstand daarmee in aanraking willen komen? Ik begrijp dat niet. Midden in de nacht, zonder mijn ouders op de hoogte te brengen, ben ik uit Eritrea gevlucht. Ik dacht dat het moeilijkste zou zijn dat ik in mijn leven zou moeten doen, zonder afscheid te kunnen nemen van mijn lieve moeder. En mijn vader vertrek als een dief in de nacht. In de hoop hen te kunnen beschermen tegen de vragen van de autoriteiten over mijn afwezigheid.
Maar waarom die gaat niet bang?
Ik weet niet.
Begrijp niet.
Nee, misschien dat ze denken dat ze echt eten krijgen.
Waarom niet bang? Normale vis als je ziet. 5 minuten weer.
Het zijn moedige vissen.
Misschien die vindt de heel, omdat heel lang hier.
Precies, ze zijn gewend, hè?
Ja. Oh.
Zo wild is hij niet, hè?
Ja, die willen niet. Ja.
Het grootste aantal vluchtelingen uit Eritrea worden in Sudan opgevangen. Daarna volgen Ethiopië, Duitsland, Zwitserland, Israël en Zweden. Sinds 2010 is de groep van minderjarigen die uit Eritrea zonder begeleiding vertrekken zeer snel toegenomen. En wij zijn maar een onderdeel van de grote exodus, die met name uit twintigers en dertigers bestaat. Mijn land is in 2010 op nummer 2, net achter Syrië, voor de hoogste aantal asielverzoek in Europa. Wij leven al 25 jaar in een dictatuur. Wij kennen geen verkiezing. Geen vrijheid van rechtspraak. Geen onafhankelijke pers. Je mag niet demonstreren. In Eritrea moet je je eigen buren bespioneren. Als je dat niet doet, kan je verdwijnen. Als je niks hebt om te rapporteren, kan je in de gevangenis belanden. Op het illegaal verlaten van het land en het ontduiken van dienstplicht staat een zware straf. Wij kunnen niet terug naar Eritrea. Nee, ik had het andersom. Ik heb hem omgedraaid. Op het illegaal verlaten van het land en het ontduiken van dienstplicht staat een zware straf. Wij kunnen niet terug naar Eritrea.
Ja, goed. Wij Nederlanders denken vaak, en Europeanen, van oh, we hebben het echt goed geregeld. Er is een democratie, er zijn verkiezingen, we studeren om dingen goed te regelen. Waardoor we denken, het systeem is neutraal, het is rechtvaardig voor iedereen. En ik denk dat dat niet klopt. En ik denk dat heel weinig mensen dat weten.
En geen grondwet. Er is wel een grondwet, denk ik. Nee. Er is geen grondwet in het land. Kan ik me niet voorstellen.
Nee, er is gewoon geen grondwet.
Geen grondwet, geen wetten?
Nee. Het is echt een volledige dictatuur.
Maar zelfs in de dictatuur heb je regels nodig, toch?
Ja, maar die zijn gewoon compleet willekeurig.
Dus ik kan me dat niet voorstellen. Ik kan me dat niet voorstellen dat er geen wetten zijn. Totaal geen wetten. Zijn er geen wetten in...
Er is een verschil, hè. Je kunt regels hebben. Maar een wet is opgeschreven en getoetst.
Ja.
Dus een wet is natuurlijk ook een middel om in rechtspraak te kunnen zeggen, er is deze wet,
ja.
Dit is het uitgangspunt, dit is waar we achter staan. Is dat toegepast of niet?
Vier keer ben ik net aan de dood ontsnapt. Ik stond voor de Middellandse Zee. Ik keek naar de rubberboot. De eerste keer zonk de boot op zo'n 75 kilometer van de Libische kust. Stond te veel wind. De boot schommelde gevaarlijk bij vertrek. Sommige mensen lagen al in het water toen de Libische kustwacht kwam. Een paar uur later was ik weer op Libische bodem. De tweede keer zijn we door de Aquarius van Artsen zonder Grenzen 140 kilometer van de kust opgepikt. Ik was niet langer bij bewustzijn. Het enige wat ik mij kan herinneren van de reddingsschip is dat naarmate de nacht vorderde, het steeds stiller werd. Het geschreeuw en het gehuil van de kinderen verstomde. Ik weet dat veel Europeanen niet begrijpen waarom wij de overtocht maken. Maar ik had slechts twee keuzes. De rubberboot of geen toekomst.
Kwijt.
Dat het een raar beeld is, dat het een ongemakkelijk beeld is.
Hij komt terug.
Ja, dit is echt niet geloven.
Come to daddy, baby. Come to daddy.
Ja, het is goed, hè? Het geluid is zo onheilspellend. Ja, ja.
Sinds september 2018 mag de Aquarius niet meer varen. Terwijl het in 2 jaar tijd 30.000 mensen heeft gered. 30.000 mensen. Geen enkel land was bereid hen een vlag te lenen. Artsen zonder grenzen vaart sinds augustus met een nieuw schip. Sea-Watch 4. De criminalisering van reddingsschepen is alleen maar toegenomen. Europese lidstaten misbruiken COVID-19 om reddingswerk te stoppen. Zie hier de staat van het Europees recht. Hulporganisaties die letterlijk levens redden, worden gecriminaliseerd. Ondertussen nemen de Griekse pushbacks toe. Boten die terug de zee op geduwd worden. Vluchtelingen die in Europese wateren terug naar Libië worden gestuurd. Libische kustwacht die door Europa betaald wordt om vluchtelingen terug te sturen.
I want to thank the Greek border guards. I want to thank the coast guards. I want to thank the civilians, the police, the servicemen and servicewomen. I want to thank Frontex for their tireless effort.
Dit zijn de woorden van EU-president Ursula von der Leyen. Frontex, de organisatie die via surveillance-tactieken Fort Europa moet beschermen tegen indringers. In 2019 betaalde de EU hen nog 460 miljoen. En dat bedrag is nog iedere jaar aan het stijgen. Sinds 2014 is er door Europa 336 miljoen aan Libië betaald voor programma's in relatie tot migranten. 91,3 daarvan is uitgegeven aan de training van de Libische kustwacht met als doel het verstevigen van de capaciteiten van grensmanagement van de Libische autoriteiten. De lijst van aanklacht tegen de Libische kustwacht is lang. Mensenrechten schendingen, zoals marteling en geweld tegen vrijwillige reddingorganisaties. Die grenswachters bestaan vaak uit voormalige milities of mensen die een onderdeel waren van de vroegere smokkelroutes. Libië wordt getekend door een onophoudend conflict sinds de val van Muammar Gaddafi in 2011. In Europa discussiëren parlementariërs over de vraag of migranten en vluchtelingen al officieel in nood zijn als het bootje nog niet aan het zinken is. Zo verklaarde een Belgische politicus tijdens de verkiezing dat die mensen, vluchtelingen dus, niet echt in nood zijn. En in Nederland willen verschillende politieke partijen mensen die op zee migranten uit bootjes oppikken vervolgen voor hulp aan mensensmokkel. Wat is het punt dat je een boot ziet op zee met honderden mensen erop, uitgedroogd, ondervoed, vol van brandwonden en je geen mensen meer ziet, maar cijfers. Geen cijfers, maar statistieken. Geen statistieken, maar parasieten. Dank u wel, meneer de voorzitter.
Ik heb de 3 keer verkocht.
3 keer, ja.
Ja, ik betaal en zeg, als je wil naar Italië, wil naar de zee, je moet geld betalen, ik betaal. En dan, ze zeggen, jullie mogen niet naar de zee. En dan, toen we gaan naar de zee gaan, ze komen anderen, ze zijn klaar met de auto zo. Dan die pak je, dan die breng je naar een andere stad zo.
Precies, en die moet je weer betalen. Ja.
En die jongens, die kennen elkaar?
Die smokkelen?
Ja.
Ja, de meeste is Eritrea, maar die heeft contact met de Libië-mensen, want het is net die maffia, zeg maar.
De smokkelaars zijn ook Eritrea?
Ja.
Ja, sommige smokkelaars is, ja. Die grote mensen is die Libië-mensen, weet je.
Ja,
Die geven huis, groot huis, en dan ook die betalen, of die Eritrea-mensen betalen van die... Die Eritrea-mensen betalen van die Libië-mensen om daar te wonen in...
Dus het is een hele netwerk.
Ja, maar dit is goed, dit verhaal, maar ik vertel het de leven, natuurlijk. Dat is de echte leven is zo.
Echt ging.
Ik wil alleen vertellen dit.
Ja.
Hoe ga je met die geel? En ik heb niet dit gebetaald, ik heb meer dan dit gebetaald. Ik heb 3 keer gebetaald.
Drie keer, ja.
En Pascal, weet je wat Pascal zo gek vond? 4.000 en 8.000 euro, alleen maar de mensen hebben dat toch niet. Pascal, kijk eens, hier hoor je dat. Geld vloeit in Afrika, het vloeit.
Ja, het komt dus ook uit alle plekken, want wij maken nu ook nog steeds geld over naar Libië. Want de jongen die hij kent, die nu nog in Libië zitten, daar maken ze de hele tijd geld over om ze weer vrij te krijgen.
Dus jij stuurt nog geld naar je vrienden?
Ja. Die daar vastzitten, ja.
Let's continue.
Yes.
Nederland heeft mij meerdere keren geprobeerd terug te sturen naar Italië. Maar daar sta ik geregistreerd als minderjarig. En minderjarigen mogen niet worden teruggestuurd. Nederland probeerde dat onder de zogenaamde Dublin Claim. Een wet die zegt dat een asielzoeker bij aankomst in Europa verplicht is zijn of haar vingerafdruk achter te laten. Dit maakt het land van aankomst verantwoordelijk voor de vluchtelingen. Geografisch komt dus erop neer dat Italië en Griekenland de meeste vluchtelingen binnenkrijgen en de grote toestroom van mensen op geen enkele manier kunnen verwerken. Wij kennen allemaal de beelden van Samos, Lesbos, Lampedusa. Mijn vraag is, wat betekent een Europese Unie als er geen enkele solidariteit is tussen de lidstaten? Als de armste zuidelijke landen de zwaarste lasten moeten dragen.
Dit lijkt op wereldhuis, toch? Die deur.
Ja, klopt.
Wat is het wereldhuis?
Ja, waterloopplein.
Ja, het wereldhuis is een plek waar vluchtelingen worden opgevangen.
Ja, die je kan heel dag.
Ook ongedocumenteerde.
Ja. Maar het is goed, hè?
Het is heel goed.
Echt waar. Maar een beetje normaal in Amsterdam, het water is een beetje...
Hoger. Ja, klopt.
Tot die mens.
Ja, je gaat bijna met je voeten erin.
Ja.
Is mooi, Amsterdam is mooi, hè?
Ja, Amsterdam is mooi.
Mooie vrouw, mooie meisjes, hè?
Ja, heel veel chickie, hè?
Ja, toch? Je weet! Ja. De zon begint te schijnen en dan komen ze even
ja,
naar buiten.
Ja, echt waar.
Je
ja.
weet.
Ik wil snel dat de zomer komt.
Ik zei het je toch, die zin moet erin. Ik voelde het. Oké, mooi man. Heb jij een vriendinnetje nu?
Nee.
Of een paar vriendinnetjes, kan ook.
Ja, ik wil het niet, maar heb ik niet echt wel.
Hij wil het niet.
Ik wil niet dat vriendin hebben dat ik zorgen van haar.
Oh, je wilt niet voor...
Alleen ik wil voor mijzelf zorgen, echt wel. Ja.
Begrijpelijk.
Ja.
Begrijpelijk.
Want het is in de asje... Ik wil, als je een goede meisje kijkt, dat ik lang met haar...
Precies.
Ik wil niet dat ik... Mijn verhaal achter mij, dat is niet goed met een meisje gedaan. Dat wil ik niet.
Oké, dus je wacht liever op de juiste, zeg maar.
Ja, goeie, die dag dat slim. Ik wil... dat ik verliefd ben.
Mijn cliënt was 15 jaar toen hij naar Nederland doorreisde. Hij hoopte daar asiel te kunnen aanvragen als minderjarige. Maar het lukt niet. Zijn asielaanvraag wordt afgewezen omdat de IND niet zeker is van zijn identiteit. Hij heeft onvoldoende documenten die als bewijs kunnen dienen. Hij heeft altijd gezegd dat hij in Eritrea geboren is. Later
is hij achtergekomen dat hij in Soedan is geboren. Hij moet het asielzoekerscentrum verlaten. Maar Italië heeft de claim afgewezen. En naar Eritrea kan hij niet terug. Op 16-jarige leeftijd is hij op straat.
Ik slaap op 25 verschillende plekken. Ik sluit me aan bij de Dublin Brothers. Een jong groep Eritreërs die de Dublin Conventie van Nederland terug moeten naar Italië.
Maar in plaats daarvan wachten ze liever 18 maanden in Nederland zodat ze opnieuw asiel kunnen aanvragen. Je komt terecht in de 24-uurs opvang voor ongedocumenteerden. Ik zit urenlang te tekenen. 'S Nachts klim ik over de schutting. Of ik ga naar de damesafdeling waar ik niet mag komen. Mijn gedachten worden steeds onafvolgbaarder. Mijn hoofd doet de hele tijd pijn.
Ik weet dat ze mij in de gaten houden. Zelfs in mijn dromen. Alle deuren lijken dicht. Ik vraag geld aan de bewakers, maar die lachen mij uit. Op een dag word ik halfnaakt aangetroffen op Amsterdam Centraal Station.
Bedelend om geld om terug te gaan naar mijn moeder. Tegen de dokter die mijn psychische problemen wil behandelen, zeg ik: ik ben niet gek. Ik heb hulp nodig voor mijn hoofd. Ik heb geen hulp nodig voor mijn hoofd. Ik heb een leven nodig.
Ik zeg tegen de dokter die mijn psychische problemen... Oké, ik had deze omgedraaid. Ik zeg tegen de dokter die mijn psychische problemen wil behandelen: ik ben niet gek. Ik heb geen hulp nodig voor mijn hoofd. Ik heb een leven nodig.
Ja, perfect.
Kan je hiermee leven of vind jij het heftig?
Nee, is normaal hoor.
Ja?
Ik snap het wel. Ik begrijp dat ik... alle mensen kan ziek worden.
Precies.
Dus ik heb alleen moeilijke maanden gehad. Maar ja. Ik ben blij dat ik nu in dit leven ben. Dit is vroeger. En ik heb ook mijn leven heel moeilijk leven gehad, dus is niks van mij.
Precies.
Dat weet ik, dat ik het ook niet. Gekke dingen doen dat ik tot nu gek ben. Ik wil niet dat mensen denken.
Precies.
Ik wil dat mensen denken. Ja, je kan gekke dingen in jouw hoofd komen, maar als je hulp krijgt, als je mensen door jou, als je. Ja, zeker, je gaat beter worden.
Precies. Nee, dus wij willen ook jou zo filmen als je nu bent. En de hele tijd laten zien hoe gezond en helder en slim je bent. Ja. En toch anders was. En dat is wat het systeem met jou gedaan heeft. Dat je daar doorheen moest, heeft jou ziek gemaakt eventjes. En Adam en ik hebben er ook lang over gesproken. Adam zei ook: oh, ik ken gekte. Ik ken het ook. Dat is nog steeds iets wat heel diep zit. Dat we altijd denken: de gekken, de zieken zijn de anderen. Ja. Maar er hoeft maar dit te gebeuren. En we zijn allemaal daar.
We zijn allemaal wel een beetje in gesprek met gekte. Als wij door moeilijke dingen in het leven gaan. Mm. Ik heb zoveel gesprekken. We hebben daarover gehad. Zoveel gesproken. Op een gegeven moment kies van: hey, ik wil niet meer naar jou luisteren. Het is genoeg. Ik ga het oplossen. Ik ga positief blijven. Want,
jij maakte zo'n gebaar.
Nu niet. Ga naar achter, jij. Mm. Van, ja. Maar ik snap het wel als je in het ACC en zo. Mijn moeder heeft 10 jaar in het ACC geleefd. In het ACC komt gekte ook heel vaak voor.
Ja.
En dat is begrijpelijk als jouw menselijkheid zo in twijfel wordt genomen, zo weg wordt gecijferd. Nou, dat is begrijpelijk als je op een gegeven moment je mond gaat vast
naaien.
Of je jezelf ophangen. Naakt gaat rondlopen, want dit is hoe jij je voelt van binnen. Dat is hoe je je voelt van binnen.
Samen ging ze dus vuur maken.
Je ging steeds kijken van die dingen.
Ja. Als je wil snel vergeten, moet iemand bij jou zijn dan die gaat praten met
precies,
je.
Precies, precies. Maar als je alleen bent...
Als je lang bent,
dan,
alleen...
Maar dan ben je in gesprek met die gekte, toch?
Ja.
Je bent in gesprek. En die spreekt, die praat gewoon tegen je van... Ja, maar je bakt er niks van. Ja, het is jouw eigen schuld. Ja. En al die dan in je op. Ik krijg een nieuw advocaat. Hij vraagt de IND om mij te registreren als minderjarige. Maar daar wil de IND niks van weten. Cliënt had zijn asielverzoek maar beter moeten voorbereiden, was het antwoord. Er rest nog één mogelijke route. Via de weg van de Raad van de Kinderbescherming. Ondertussen proberen wij een nieuw asielverzoek in te dienen bij de IND. Een vrijwillige heeft via tussenpersonen €300 overgemaakt. Voor een inentingenboekje. Schoolrapporten smokkelen uit. En opgegroeid. Op vrijdag 6 maart. Besluit de jeugdrechter, naar aanleiding van het rapport van de Raad van de Kinderbescherming, dat ik minderjarig ben en weer onder voogdij moet worden geplaatst. Dat de IND mij als meerderjarig ziet, de reden waarmee de meeste van mijn problemen in Nederland begonnen zijn, verklaart de jeugdrechter ongeldig. Ik ben zo blij. Op 19 mei 2020 krijg ik te horen dat de IND mijn asielverzoek alsnog goedkeurt. Mijn wereld draait om. De eerste dagen lukt het me niet om te praten. Het is alsof ik mijn stem kwijt ben. Ik kan me niet herinneren hoe lang ik dit al wil. En nu heb ik het. Hoe moet je leven als het plots weer kan? Ik ga nog steeds naar dezelfde plekken. Ik ga naar de huiskamer waar de Dublin Brothers bij elkaar komen. Die nog steeds aan het wachten zijn op hun verblijfsvergunning. Wij drinken koffie. Wij roken sigaretten. Wij spelen kaarten. Ik val nog steeds in slaap op dezelfde bank. Ik kijk TikTok-filmpjes met mijn vriend Jonas. Alles zal anders moeten zijn. Ik mag blijven. Maar er verandert niks. Sinds een paar maanden woon ik... in een studio in Amsterdam. Ik heb mijn eigen keuken, mijn eigen badkamer. Maar ik kan niet wennen aan het stilte. Hier ben ik dan. Net 18 jaar geworden. Aan het begin van een leven vol met littekens. Een beschadigde ziel. En in plaats van mij te focussen op mijn schoollessen... op het maken van vrienden, het luisteren naar muziek, versieren van meisjes, spelen van voetbal, sta ik hier. Een verhaal te vertellen waar ik eigenlijk geen zin in heb. Ik ben net 18 jaar geworden. En mijn leven moet nog beginnen in dit Europa. Noodgedwongen zoek ik mijn vlucht in het theater. Dat door corona stilstaat. Zo ben ik in deze film terechtgekomen waarvan ik niet eens weet wie er zit te kijken. Het theater en nu deze film zijn een metafoor geworden. Hier tonen wij de werkelijke rechtsstaat. Een recht dat zonder papieren geen kind van een volwassene kan onderscheiden. Een plek waar zonder geboortebewijs geen recht gesproken kan worden. Een recht... dat niet om kan gaan met het geheugenverlies die ontstaan uit diepe trauma's. Waarom kan ik niet gewoon 18 jaar zijn? Ik wil herenigd worden met mijn familie. Ik wil een tweede kans. En wat is dit voor maatschappij? Waar politiek niks bewogen kan worden. Maar je geen bioscoop of theater kan bezoeken zonder te horen hoe onrechtvaardig het systeem is. Worden jullie zelf niet gek van de dagelijkse schizofrenie? Alles is business as usual, totdat je een theater of een bioscoop bezoekt en je dan geconfronteerd wordt met het leed dat onder jullie luxe ligt. Onder jullie bescherming, onder jullie rijkdom. Hoeveel kennis hebben jullie nog nodig om in beweging te komen?
Het probleem is niet dat jullie niet zouden kunnen weten. Het probleem is dat jullie alles zouden kunnen weten als jullie maar zouden willen. Ik ben te jong om dit verhaal te vertellen. Ik spreek jullie taal onvoldoende. En dus vertelt Adam Kissekel en schreef Lara Staal deze woorden. Zij vertelde dat ze mij een verhaal wilde vertellen. Ik zei gelijk, niet alleen het mijne. Dit gaat niet alleen over mij. Het gaat over zoveel anderen. Ze knikte.
Dit zijn niet mijn woorden. Ik ben Samuel. Ik zou nooit zo zeggen, kijk naar mij. Dit zijn niet mijn woorden. Dit zijn de woorden van Lara. Die uitspreekt door Adam, acteur die op mij speelt. Mij en vele anderen die op mij lijken. Wat jullie niet weten is, Samuel niet bestaat. Zijn verhaal is mijn verhaal. Gebaseerd op mijn dossier. Vele achtergrond artikelen over vluchten Eritrea's. Maar Lara laat mij dingen zeggen die ik zelf zou nooit zeggen. Ze laat mij dingen zeggen die ik zelf nooit zou denken. Kijk maar, ik glimlach eigenlijk iedere dag. Toch?
Toch.
Zoals we daarnet hadden gezegd, gaan we nu nog heel kort nagesprekje samen met Parwana Amiri, die we daarnet al aan het woord hebben gehoord, en Lara Staal, die vanuit Duitsland zo meteen gaat inzoomen. Het gaat nog een hele kleine technische ombouw zijn. We gaan het scherm een beetje naar achter doen. Lara gaat van op het digibord inzoomen. We gaan zo meteen van start gaan.
Lara, this is Kasia. Can you hear us?
Absolutely, very loud and clear.
Nice. Okay, we're just changing seats to see you in our conversation. Hello, Lara. Didn't see you for a long time.
Funny, I'm seeing myself double.
Okay.
And I hear myself double, though. It gets a bit less convenient.
We're changing, we're still seeing if the technical issues can be resolved, so you can hear us well. And maybe I can get like a sign from the technique that everything works well. And then Parwana will also sit down next to us, and then we will start the conversation. Just one moment.
Maybe as we are waiting, I don't know, Lara. Did you watch it for like a brief? Could you follow it? Because I can imagine it's been a while since you've seen the movie for the last time.
Indeed, yeah. It was funny because I was a little bit conflicted between trying to prepare myself and catch up as much as I could by watching again the program you've organized this weekend and looking a bit at the work of Parwana. seeing the Super magazine and all the articles there. But also, I had just, joy is the wrong word, but it was good to see the movie back again and to take that chance. I still hear myself double though, with delay, so it makes it difficult to concentrate. I don't know if there's anything to do about that, but...
We will try to resolve that. Before that, I want to introduce you to Parwana Amiri, sitting here with us on stage. Parwana, this is Lara. Lara, this is Parwana. And we will speak today about art and justice and activism. So, is the hearing better, Lara, for you? Can you hear us well?
I hear you perfectly. The thing is that I hear myself a little bit with delay, but it's already a bit better.
Okay. So we will try now.
I will try to concentrate anyway.
Okay, we will try our best. First, Parwana, can you formulate maybe a first impression after seeing the movie of Lara?
Hello, Lara. I'm very happy to meet you. Honestly, it was very. I can say that it was so expressive. You know, all the details, all the things that, you know, all the faces that we really needed. I have been also under the camera, and I have been also working with the meditators and also the filmmakers and journalists for a long time, for 2 years of life in Rizona camp. During my time in media, and one of the complaints that I had sometimes from the journalists especially was that they were showing only one picture and was keeping only one image of who is a refugee, how we are, and only by spending 2 or 3 hours they wanted to show a new image of us or our life to the people that they wanted to, you know more about our life. But it was for me something impossible, because you need to spend the time with those that you are taking the documentary, or you are working, or you want to show the their film or anything, or even a piece of photo. You need to really have this contact. And I really felt that the camera was a friend with Samuel and Adam, if I'm not mistaken, the name of the two young boys. And so this was very, you know, inspiring, I can say. So congratulations for your very transparent work and movie that you presented, really.
Lara, would you like to respond to that?
I mean, it's it means a lot to hear that from you. Really means a lot. And it's a very difficult challenge, I think, because you're always confronted yourself with your own outside gaze. You always stay an outsider, and that's something you need to deal with your own privilege, with the subjectivity, with camera somehow always trying to give the impression of the real world. So it's every decision is very, very loaded, and there's a huge responsibility. And I must say, seeing it again, I find it very difficult to look at myself. I have many problems with how I speak, and therefore it was very good to do this with Pascal Poisonnier, the documentary maker, because in the end, he was also looking at me as something that needed to be contextualized. And I think that's one of the key things, is that you should not work alone, and you need diversity in the team, and you need as much horizontality and exchange. So, for example, Adam was on many levels not just an actor, but connected with the topic and with me and with the project, and very critical, and asking me many questions and confronting us on many layers. So you need to organize your own critique also.
Thank you, Lara. Before going maybe to your work again, I would like to pose you the question, Parwana, about your art. And you use your poetry to talk, among others, about the thousands of people and their stories you see around you in Rizona camp, for example. on Lesbos. You could say that you started this undertaking in the fall of 2019, when you started a blog, which we already mentioned today, which I hope everybody will read now, Letters to the World from Moria, which you started to write as soon as you entered the camp and saw the daily problems of the people you met there. And could you maybe give us some insight in your artistic history? And you spoke about it also in your kind of activist lens, why you started writing, but as a poet, when and why was it that you started writing poetry?
Thank you for your three clear questions. Honestly, according to the first one, I can say I was writing because I felt really important to give a voice from people inside by a person that is also impacted by the condition. It's like many of the feminist people, they claim and they always ask others for men not to write about their stories of the story of a woman. For me, it was a bit hard to understand that somebody who doesn't live under the same circumstances as we were living comes for 1 or 2 hours and spending some time and exchange of some words and then writes a script. So I was saying that not all those feelings, not all those expressions that had to be expressed, not the right words and not using only drama on that text could be expressed. So from the first time, I don't know, there was a feeling saying, because I also was, you know, somehow facilitator of the program of the journalists and the authors or those that they were working for the university, they were also coming and reaching me in order to provide a distance of, you know, giving contact with the families that they were in the camp, so for them to write. But while working with them, I could see that they were not able to mention, and it was totally normal not to be able to mention all those important parts of their life, not only their drama, but also how do they smile, why do they smile, what is their strength, you know, because this strength is motivational. The way that they still support each other, even they are not even supported, was motivational. So these parts of things were not highlighted, they were not mentioned in the text, and many other parts, like the film. So for me, writing was also like a film. I needed to show everything in the story. And I can claim that the unique part of my work was that from very first beginning, I didn't, you know, represent the story of the refugee that I was in contact or was in close relation, and I was or she was telling the story. I was giving the voice to themselves, saying that I am doing this, I am the mother of 2 children, or my children are like this, and putting myself in their soul and understanding as much as possible, because I was also in the same condition, and it was, I can say, easier for me rather than those that they were coming from outside of the camps. And regarding to the question about poetry, poetry suddenly came to my world of writing. It was a rhythm behind the words that was, you know, and that was structuring a new form of the literature lines. And the activism that was the hardest and the most challenging part of my work, because if you're a girl that you were born in a patriarchal family and you were born in a, you grieve up in a, you know, cultural society, then you become a refugee, you're Muslim, you are a girl, you are young, discredited because of the not having educational degree, was really hard to face all those challenges and obstacles, and to also act in the southeast border of European zone, in margin of Europe, in Greece, because I was not only, you know, challenging the problems inside of the camp to the communities, to the internal community, and but also trying to tell that the way that you are treating each other is, you know, will become tougher when you will face the treatment of the people outside, because we were facing discrimination inside of the camp and also outside of the camp. We were not accepting the communities themselves. We were not able to accept each other. And another way, the community outside were not accepting us. So there was a big complexity of trying to present this condition to the communities inside of the camp in order to bring another image of them to the world outside. And I was really feeling having a very heavy responsibility under my shoulder. But I was also feeling that I needed to keep this strength because I had the knowledge, I was able to speak and communicate. I had a small circle of people that they were supporting my words and were sharing my words with their group of people.
Thank you, Parwana. Maybe I want to ask a similar sort of reflectionary question to Lara. Maybe some of you already seen it. Recently, we published a catalog. It's called The Catalog of Resistance. We have one, a little promotion insert. Among others, these two beautiful people were willing and invited our invitation to write a contribution for it. But I remember when I asked Lara if she would be interested to write something, I mentioned, why don't you write something about Zach Samuel and the creation process and the thinking process that got behind it. For you, it was immediately clear. I mean, you also mentioned it in the text that the project Zach Samuel already started much longer, like much more earlier on, with a project you did in 2018 called Europe on Trial. It was a mock tribunal you did together with the activist Younis Osman Nour, and in which you sued the European Union for the atrocities it brought about as a result of an inhumane migration policy. In the text, which is really, I don't have like a preference of all the contributions, but I remember that when Lara was writing it and you said, Aline, I have no idea if this is going somewhere, I was like, no, this is so valuable and interesting and valuable in the way that you are also very transparent and open in this struggle in making this disengaged art on topics such as migration. So my question to you would be, like, how did your artistic practice evolve over these 4 years, starting with Europe on Trial, then turning to Zach Samuel?
I think one of the challenges is to become is to not become cynical. That we should not feel any space to become cynical. We should only feel the space to be even more responsible and to never give up hope. But that is difficult. And I think in the moment that you do many or several projects around migration, the status of refugees, undocumented people in the world, you just, I mean, it's very difficult not to become very hopeless, because it looks very bad and it already for a very long time, and it's difficult to see shifts. I mean, luckily we're not alone, and there is a community of, and there are many amazing people speaking about it. But in a way, I find it incredible, very hard to believe that I'm part of a world that systematically dehumanizes people. And as I also mentioned in the text, to speak with the words of Omar Schatz, lawyer, we're living a genocide against refugees trying to reach Europe. And that's a very, I mean, it just removes every feeling of power, or it's even the feeling of not understanding the world you live in a way. And then, I don't know, looking at the election, see how people vote, how to get up in the morning and thinking like, okay, but what I do matters and I can try to change something. So I think when I started Europe on Trial, from several engagement actually, because also Europe on Trial was not the first project I have been working with Here to Support before. They're also mentioned in the film. So Fana is one of the coordinators, Cole, that you saw also in the movie. And my contact and exchange with them has been very important. They were also a school to me, understanding the complexity. And they grew out of a protest of a tent camp, actually, in Amsterdam, of refugees assembling together publicly in the street, showing that they didn't have any rights, no house, no income, no healthcare, no future, and deciding to not longer hide and become invisible, but actually showing we exist and we are also your problem. And I think back then, and also in my collaboration with Younes Osman Noor, I was very hopeful. I had the feeling that we were doing something extremely important and that it might be picked up and shift things. And it certainly has been super important on many layers. But it didn't have, I mean, I could not imagine we would not get on the front papers of the news. And of course we didn't. We didn't even, I mean, not even a very little, let's say. So it's that, I think that's one of the things that very quickly you understand that it's a war of getting attention, to get attention and to be taken seriously. And especially in art that has been so much institutionalized in the West and seen as some sort of, you know, safe space for people to be critical and provocative, but in such a way that you don't really have to respond to it. That I think for us artists and activists who really want to transform and be part of the discussion and have power, it's a struggle to overcome those limitations.
Well, to not end hopeless, we have more questions to both of you. But thank you. I think, Parwana, you are one of the reasons that gives me hope doing the art I do. And I was very happy that also Lara felt that was inspiring to hear what you thought about her movie. I think these kind of conversations are needed for all of us to not lose hope. So I have a question to both of you. Maybe you want to cite one of the thoughts that were formulated by Lara in the text?
It's a question that we prepared, and I again return to the contribution. I will cite one of the basically your words, Lara, because I really think it's a very interesting thinking exercise that we can ask ourselves when we are discussing like engaged arts and the potential that we can have as artists in really like feeding and changing the public debates. So I quote, "Is the possibility of having a voice enough? The potential to find a community that is willing to listen enough to have an emancipating effect? Or must there be concrete results before you can ask a victim to repeat their suffering?" That's of course like a very important or very present question. I can imagine that you had in your mind constantly when you were making the case Samuel, Zach Samuel. But I can imagine that it's also present in your work, Parwana, in the blog when you were writing you were really like sharing or giving voices to the people whom you saw around you when you were in the last years. In your opinion, do you think that art can change the reality for affected people in a positive way by, for example, telling empowering stories of marginalized people or by an exploration of their social voice, for example? Maybe you can go first if you want to.
I think it's always important to act
I mean, when I was giving some workshops to the young people in the assembly that we self-organized inside of the Rizona during these 2 years, then on that, you know, in some of the workshops and some of the programs that we were running and we were discussing about the things that we self-explored from the life being in the camp, we noticed that there is always the time that when you don't do something, nothing will be moved, nothing will be changed. But when you do and you use your knowledge and your creativity in any possible ways, it always impact, it always affect. While talking about effect, we were not talking about an effect that would change our life in 2 days or would change our life or the perspective of others that were living outside of the camp in the local community. We were using the art because we wanted to make change in the circle groups of the people that we were living in. It was always for us to use the art not to make awareness in the outside world, but also in the camp as well. I'm talking about 3,000 people from 5 different communities living in a camp that was in the 72 kilometer north of Athens. And for taking bus, we had to pass 20 minutes distance, and after that wait for the bus for 1 hour or 2 hours, and to get it and to pay and to not even sometimes be sure that you can return back on time or would stay in the park in Athens. So these were the daily life challenges that we were facing. There are many of the young people that they had, you know, they were using art, but they didn't know in which way they can use it or how they can express their feelings through the art. And we didn't have too much resources to share with them in order to give them a new perspective of the artistic creativities and also the hard work and the impact that it can bring and the loud voice of art that has in the society. But we could organize many of these artistic works with different communities of inside of the camp and for raising awareness about solidarity, about accepting the differences and having more information about the internal communities we were living together. So it is a matter of what you really want to, what kind of change you're talking and sometimes it's like sustainable and sometimes it is just to, you know, bring more voices on this on the birds.
Maybe also very like to Lara, what I mean, of course it's a question that you asked in the text, but I can imagine about it afterward, like in constantly, basically, when you're also making art. Where does for you lie the potential of this emancipatory effect that art can have?
I very much agree with Parwana that I think it's not one thing and that it matters what kind of layers we're thinking, and I anyway think that we are changing and transforming all the time, also by just being on the earth, just living your life, you're having influence on the lives of people around you all the time. So in the way we talk and speak and exchange, we do change things, that therefore language is important. It's important how we talk about things because it shapes reality. And so certain words should not be mentioned or they should be contextualized and other words should be used. Therefore, we don't speak about illegal people because illegal people is not something that exists, at least not in my reality. You cannot be illegal. It's a problematic word. So I think already on that level, then I think in the project I did, there was the inner circle, so that the team, the people you work with, and in the case Samuel, that was of course with Samuel, with Adam, with Here to Support, And Europe on Trial, there were many people involved, many undocumented people also. So of course you try to make a difference for the people involved, but you can have sleepless nights because of that. Because what is enough change? And how concrete should it be? And how much power do we have? And can someone be part of a project without you being able to secure or to guarantee that their lives will be changed or heard? And I think that's the third layer, and it has to do with that we live in a democracy, which means a diversity of voices coexisting together, and you never know when you make something or you express something what the effect will be. And in a way, you should always think that it might be the beginning of a revolution. And in the end, revolutions, I mean, we tend to look at history and say, yes, that poem or that person that that stood up in the bus, or, you know, but in the end, nobody does that alone. It's always a matter of timing, momentum, other voices, community, a longer, for something to hit something, to hit a nerve and to really start a change. There has been made already a fruitful ground by many other people. And I think that's very important, that you always work on the work of your ancestors and of your sisters and brothers and the same, I mean, next door to you, that you might know or you don't know, but you're always in dialogue with other voices, which is beautiful and very frustrating, because it also might that it's not, you don't have the good timing, and it's maybe not even your fault, it's just the time is not ripe because you cannot do it alone. And what do you do in the meantime? You try not to stop, you try to continue the work. Even though, it maybe not have the huge effect yet that you would wish for. And I think in this case, it's just a matter of making art about a subject that you still don't really understand it's happening. It's just ethically almost impossible to really grasp what you're talking about. And I think that's what we also tried in the case Samuel to include, that while making it, we're still puzzled about the cruelty of life and inequality and unfairness.
Thank you, Lara. So Parwana and Lara, you've been already kind of responding the last question we have to you, but in a kind of mode of self-reflection, what School of Resistance is always about in the last 2 years. I mean, I remember, Lara, we had a conversation right after Moria burned down with Mohammed Al-Kashef and Efi Latsoudi from Pikba camp. Then we met again, Parwana. We met last September when the war, when Afghanistan was left alone again, and we had our School of Resistance where we worked in Cologne with Omar Schatz, that was mentioned, trying to sue kind of the European government on a symbolic level. And yeah, I also at this moment last Sunday when the German government decided to spend 100 billion more euros for weapons right now because of the Ukraine crisis. And I felt like my work, also of the last 1.5 years, is not doing anything. And I think we all experience this sometimes, but this weekend gave me another hope to also see and meet the amazing people in Ghent and the initiatives that are doing amazing work. So I just want to ask the both of you kind of your last words, and maybe Aline, you also want to add something. despite all the difficulties you mentioned, also Lara specifically, towards the potential of art, we hear very strong and powerful voices in the movie, but also today on stage. And how is the last question maybe for this weekend? How is art a tool of survival and hope, and how?
Parwana, please.
Mm. talking about writing, I can say that I write because I want to change the narration. I want to change the narration that has been always about who we are, where we come from, and why do we come from, but also not mentioning in what condition do we live in. I write because I want to bring more alternative narration in the world and to clean the adequate narration that usually exists. I write because, you know, writing is, of course, it's a suffering story. It is a suffering process. And while observing everything, you are also, you suffer more. Because for me, writing about somebody that has a problem, a young person who has addiction problem, I need to put my soul in his soul and to understand that condition. How is it to sleep and to open your eyes, to feel everyday's life like that, and why that addiction feels for him to be free, you know, not to live on that condition anymore. So for me, it was hard, and so it is a suffering story. You need to understand everything so deeply in order to bring a new image out and to change what was existed before, and you don't totally agree about it. I can also say that, what was this last part of the question?
The last part of the question, it was how art can be a tool of survival. Yeah. And hope.
For all those that they have this weapon, for all those that they use the art in any form that has existed as a tool of resistance and strength, it's important to really use it, because art, writing words and everything that brings new things and creative the things that was not existed before is something that we needed. If I would have the words and the stories of the people and experiences of the ones that experienced the same things as I was living in before, and I would know how did they stand against those challenges. I know there were many activists before me. I know that I'm on the shoulder of many people that they stood in this way and they struggled against the condition and the system. But if I don't have many of those approvals that I need to have in order to read and to understand how was the condition that time and what kind of challenges they were facing, what kind of strategies they used in order to make the condition lightened, and they kept up that strength, I would not face the suffering process that I was under in 2 years of life in the camp. It's always needed to give more proofs, approvals and documents to the ones that they will become after us. So for me, I don't want to have one day have the words and in my head that why I didn't write the words I could write, the poems I could create, the comments I could complain about the system. And for me, it has been always a time that I say that we live only once. And if I don't write about the condition that the system put us to live in and to feel that everything was going well and there was no problem and it was everything was normal, then the ones after me will do the same thing. I did it because I wanted to make sure that the young people and all the refugees in the camp and in other camps that they heard of the same strategy that I used, they will do the same thing. They will share their stories, and they will not suffer this pain alone, and will ensure that there are other people that they know about their life and waiting not for hope, but they will create hope. They will not wait for support, but they will support each other. They will not wait in order to get strength from others, but they will inspire others to stay strong. So this is the way that we are surviving. And I can say Rizzona was not a place that we were trying to survive. It was like another fight after the first life that we had in the camps, like in Moria, in the islands. So it's always about the time. It's always about your hopes and your dreams that you see that they are getting sung. And if you wait for that song, it will be continued. But if you use the literature, the art, and all forms of it, you will understand that there is something alight in front of you. And so for me, literature in all forms of it and art has been a way to see the hope in the darkness.
Feels like a beautiful ending. I don't know if we should be silent, just kind of letting Parwana's words echo or start an applause. But I'm not sitting in the space with you, unfortunately, so I cannot feel there. couple of thoughts I will try to articulate. I again very much agree with what Parwana said. Change the narration. I think change the narration is very beautifully said. Because if it comes in the case of migration policies, we are confronted with a form of normalization that is incredible. And I think we continue to have so many blind spots on so many levels. I remember Olivia Ruta-Zipwa, who was one of the lawyers, academic writer, one of the lawyers at the Europol trial, and I made an order of speakers, and the idea was that we would try to have speakers from left and right, and she said, like, don't start with the white man of 50 years old who has more of a kind of a right-wing discourse. And I realized I did that because I had the feeling that I should show some sort of weird objectivity that doesn't exist or something. Start with the people that somehow need the platform, and they should put the standard. Choose a young academic woman of color who did an incredible research about undocumented people and the amounts of numbers, she will set the standard. And the other one is one of the voices. We still tend to think that what we ask for is utopian, but what we ask for should be normal. I mean, the least. And I think that's something we should continue to remember. Even if we listen to presidents, political people, whatever, talking about, how much percentage can we offer refuge or not? Is this person entitled to stay there? Is this a real refugee or is this actually an economic gold seeker? We should not accept that language. It's a frame. It's framing. It should be fought. So if you think then the change of the narration is very important, and then how can art be a tool of hope? I think hope is indeed, it's a good question, because hope is political. It's a construction, in a way. I think our feeling of powerlessness is also a very adequate discourse. It's almost a tool, and it's not one person, I don't know, using that somehow, but it's, I think, a very deep feeling. I recently made a piece with teenagers, so-called dropouts in school, problem kids, whatever we call them, and one of the teachers we've interviewed just said, like, yeah, we always tend to think the teacher has power, but you're just standing alone for a group of, I don't know, 20 teenagers. You will never be able to do whatsoever if there's not consent or support from that group. So I think the thing of powerlessness and not having hope is very political, and we should be very aware that there is no privilege to be hopeless. We cannot, especially not we people with so many privileges. It's really not up for us to feel powerless. And of course we do, And of course we're frustrated and so, but it's not an option. It's just not an option. And then I'm afraid to talk too long because I have the feeling I'm not with you in the space, so I cannot feel. So we'll try to now really round up. But in the text I mentioned maybe one of the reasons to keep on making projects about the same thing, although there have been such fantastic, important trials, documentaries, books about refugee policies, migration, border politics, etc., is just to not get crazy. It's really important not to get crazy and to stick with the truth you feel is under pressure and to just keep on repeating it, even though you have the feeling maybe nobody hears it. And I think what Parwana says is very true. There are people that need to hear they're not alone. They're not alone. And we will keep on repeating it. And let's hope we will be part of that generation that sees difference, but it cannot be a reason not to continue.
Thank you, Lara. Even though time is ticking, I would very much like to give you guys also the opportunity to, if there is something that you want to share, because of course we have set on a two-day trajectory. It has been super valuable in my opinion, but it has also been quite intense. But as Lara said, like as artist activist, you're not doing it alone. There are people always feeding the context, are creating context, are doing valuable work every day. So that's why I would like to ask, I will stand up because I don't see you because of the light. If there is maybe some, if there are some people who still want to share like something, yeah.
Thank you. Hello, good evening. I just want to make some remark. I followed the movement in Netherlands. It was in 2016 where undocumented people start mobilizing by the name of We Are Here. So it was, we estimated the in Netherlands it could be like over 35 to 50,000 people who are living under the poverty and in the status of irregular, which has been dropped by the asylum procedure in Netherlands. So my first, I just want to make these remarks because it's very important that it's been 2 years that in the European level, most of the there is a new impact which has been negotiating. It's over the asylum and immigration, how to treat the files. So they are just trying to make a new policy to block those people who are coming to the Western European by creating the centers in the country which are attached with the state of European Union. So we could already imagine that the policy which already discriminates the refugees inside the Western European country, so we could imagine that things could go more worse because the camp which was created, the Moria camp, it was just one of that policy which was exercised in the ground to see as an example what will is going to happen there. So, and as being from Afghanistan, we present here the undocumented people, the national undocumented platform in Belgium, and we estimate the triple side of that in Belgium we could go more to 150,000 people who are living in the same situation, who were the asylum seekers at the first, the majority of that, and right now they are living in the same status. So we thought too much about the policies what are here been going. We do understand about all our thoughts goes with the Ukrainian people because we do experience that nightmare, that time that we were left alone, and we think that and we estimate that the Ukrainian people are in the same situation. That's why the state secretary of for asylum and immigration in Belgium made a new operation to provide a temporary protection for this for the Ukrainian people, in through which they just want to, and just in through just they wanted to put one people against another people. So we don't want to get in that trap. We don't accept that. We show our all solidarity to any individual who is suffering and who is a victim of war in the global politic. So we just wanted, so that's why we made a project here in Belgium by an association which is named the House of Europe. It's called, but in the French, La Maison du Peuple d'Europe. So this they realize a new project in which we will have a speak person who will participate in every forum and conference which will be related to immigration, diversity, economic and social issues. So that's what we are trying to do there. It's our objective, and we will go to through because we believe in that those people who are concerned, they have to be in the first line to give their thoughts and also to express the way and to also somehow collaborate for the reasons that concerns to them directly. Because in the state of European Union or in the European institution, it's all the time the politicians who decide on the behalf of the other people. Here right now we have we started a campaign by the name of In My Name with some partners, which is a citizen initiative. Like we have this new, voila, I say we have this, but Belgium have this new law that it has been adopted by since 2 or 3 years, that any citizen who wants to depose a subject, and over that it should open a debate in the parliament or in the federal parliament. So with collecting the 25 signatures of the citizens, this proposition will go to the Europe, to the national or to the Belgian parliament, and they will it will be open a debate. We hope, that's what we say, the hope. So we hope that we will reach to that signature, and we will going to start restart again our meeting and our lobbying to see all those politicians who are presenting the government here. So I just want also to have some thoughts for the all women in the world, but especially and uniquely for the Afghan women. It's not because that I am from that country, but because I have experienced these things. Like I can give a very short that my dad left the family when I was 10 years old, and we were three brothers and one sister. So it was only our mother, I can say, that who played a true role as a mother and as a father, that she grew up, she make everything possible that we could get knowing our life. We will be good educated, and we will be having good manners to each person who is front to us. Lastly, in Afghanistan, there was the artist named Shamsia Hosseini, who was also an artist who do everything the best inside the Kabul city by doing the street arts. So it gives too much courage for the women in Afghanistan to get out of that that I can say that change in which they were living, because it is very difficult. It's a man's world in Afghanistan, so women have no much authority to choose the way they have to
Mr.
live.
Or Arthur, even thank you very much. We would like to have more remarks out of your statements, but if you want to have your question after...
No, it's early we said it's not about question, we just do some remarks. So
I just want to say thank you for that. And what we can definitely do is exchange contacts also with you and Lara. The In My Name campaign, we just do believe we still want to give space for very short questions or remarks, because we had two long days, and I do believe the moment, and I don't want to like cut it, but we've been listening, and I do believe it's very important now that, of course, connections will be made throughout this whole weekend, but I still want to give the chance to maybe one other person saying something very short. Other than that, we will open the bar to speak in this group.
I will just take more 30 seconds, I can
say.
Okay,
yes, thank you.
So finally, I just want a role which has been done by Lady Parwana Amiri here, because it's not so much easy for the Afghan women in the situation they live through in the society inside Afghanistan or outside. And when we do need some actors like her, to honor and also to make anything possible that the million other voice could or should be listened. And in the last, because I know that how much it takes for the organization or the for you guys that you make this possible, as yesterday the event goes in the Jakubkirk and here. So I just lastly want to thank everybody who participated in this organization and make it possible, and hope it will go more ahead. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. A very short last question or remark before we can, I think, all also have a drink if we want and speak these things. Yeah, there's one last. Please keep very short. Yeah.
More than two, I just want to say one thing. We were talking about hope and about power and the idea that you want to reach out to the media and stuff. And I just want to say that you must know that both the movie, but also your poems really gave feeling to this event. And that you must know that maybe it was not picked up by any big journals or any big thing, but that for this, for events like this, they do a lot, and they send the feeling that over to the rest of us, and it's very powerful. And that you must understand that that the classical media are disappearing; they are getting lower and lower, and that the future is for modern media. And that what you are making, both your poems and the movie, that it really touches people, and that it will be shown and be listened to by a lot of people who will be very inspired by you guys. Thank you for that.
Thank you. And I think now is the moment to say goodbye and last word from everybody. Parwana, if you want to say something to Lara.
Thank you very much, Lara. Your work was like, it was very inspiring, and I really hope that most of the media and mass media and all those that they are trying to show another image of refugees and their life and their narration to get inspired by your work. And it was really, really encouraging and inspiring for me as well. So thank you, and I'm very happy and honored to know you as well and meet you.
Likewise, it's such a pity we cannot sit together there on that stage, but I'm also very grateful that we still had a chance to meet, and I'm very much looking forward also to follow your work. So thanks a lot for your words, that mean a lot, and thanks for the audience, for the organizers, for the weekend. It's so important to keep on getting together. Yes, and share and join forces.
As a last question, Lara, shortly I want to mention something. Maybe it would be better to use it to send your private message. But did you also give the camera to the actors of the movie or no? I just wanted to know this.
Very good question. I remember we've been speaking about it, but I think in the end it was also not me holding the camera, but it was Pascal Poignet, the filmmaker. And he decided to really film the entire process. But we didn't, and we also spoke about should he not also become visible in the movie, like his power somehow. He's mentioned once by Adam, who speaks about him. But we didn't change roles, which we could have, and it's a good point. Funny enough, now in my last project around education, we did had a moment where we gave the camera to the performers, the teenagers, and let them ask us questions. So I think this reverse of power is very important. And also what you spoke about roles and how refugees are being put into images always as victims and stuff. Looking again at the film, and I think that's something that art can do, is this kind of weird playfulness where you can change power relations because you are creating a new context where you can play with images and with narration and with power relations. So therefore it was very important that Samuel would be the lawyer as well as the one sitting in court.
Thank you very much for your insightful answer. It was really satisfactory. And inshallah, in the next project, we will see that this weapon, we can call the camera, will be shared more among the actors as well. It's really important terms of art. So thank you again.
Well, thank you. Thank the both of you, Parwana, Lara, also for joining us online. I feel very honored, very happy to have the both of you here present in this conversation. I've learned a lot. I definitely also don't want to wrap up the conversation. Let's continue it. Let's have a second School of Resistance in Ghent next year, or it hasn't been planned yet, but let's already look forward to continue this journey, because it's definitely not
after School of Resistance is before School of Resistance.
Yes. Thank you.